I wish I could give you a clear answer. Like, I wish I could just tell like a hobbyist, this is how you should buy, this is what you should do, these are the guidelines. But there isn't any set guidelines at this point. I mean, hopefully eventually will be, but it's just kind of a crapshoot at this point, you know? So, you know, I guess if you plan on being a beekeeper for the next 10 years, just kind of trial and error and find breeders and producers that you like and start working with them.
Live conference down there, and it was kind of cool because Frank Rinkovich was at one of the local meetings talking about VSH, and some of the people from Missouri around St. Louis were down there. Somehow my name came up, and Frank's like, you should have him come out and visit. And I was gonna visit anyway because I wanted to see Garett Dodds, and one of the guys I worked on my master's degree with is an intern down there, so I got to catch everybody while I was there. Ben Nichols, I think he's working on that.
Yeah, he's talking about you. Yep. Yeah, because I think I left like the day beforehand. So
yeah.
But yeah, it's kind of a cool lab to see. Like it's different than you expect when you first get down there, where you can expect like a giant lab. But I mean, basically, it's the same structure as when it was built in the 30s, and then the new addition in the 60s. So it's, you know, it's definitely a historical landmark.
It's pretty awesome. From my perspective as a bee breeder, it's the lab to go visit, you know.
Oh, it's awesome. Yep. And all the history too. It's amazing. Yep. And it's cool. So, like, all the researchers there, like Bob Danica coming around still, and Renderer's there, and yep.
Too cool.
And Harbo, obviously.
Yeah, that's awesome.
That guy.
Yeah, I've just had email correspondence with him from being in his breeding group and whatnot and VSH type stuff, but James has hung out with him. I've not sat face to face with John. Actually, I'd love to meet him sometime.
During at the vendor hall at the ABF, it was the guy was selling one of the dental loops, you know, and John was really interested in it. It was kind of neat to see a side of his personality you don't get to interact with. Like, if you talk to him on the phone, or like, he's usually just very short, like,
oh yeah,
and not in a rude way. He just like doesn't care to talk on the phone, it seems, but he was almost kind of mischievous. It was interesting because when we were looking at the dental loops, he was trying to talk the guy into selling the dental loop right now. And the guy was only selling these like dental loops, but he wanted you to pay for them and then mail them back to you later. And it was like, John looked at me, he goes, he just took all the fun out of it.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, kind of. Cause like, I was ready to buy too. And when he said that he was going to mail, I'm like, you're going to lose a lot of sales doing that, bro.
Yeah. I would like to have a pair. I've got a cheapy pair, but my eyesight's still not too bad for 42, but I have them for backup.
What's up, Matt?
Not too much.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey. You guys saw that snow down there in Indiana?
Oh, we've got, I guess we got a little bit of snow on Monday, but it melted right away. So, yeah, it's been really great weather, actually.
You're in northern Indiana or southern?
Indianapolis, so like central. So, yeah, I think we missed most of it. I think, like, Lafayette and Purdue, I think they got a lot of snow. But, yeah, Indianapolis, we got a little bit, I think, on Monday, but it melted right away. It was great. But, baby, you guys got a lot of snow in Michigan, right?
Matt did.
Yeah, we still have quite a bit on the ground. It's not gone yet. It'll be gone by next week. But it's been, like, rainy and misty. So it's, like, really foggy in the mornings. And but it's melting. It's really, like, slushy. And then, it, you know, it packs down and then freezes at night and then thaws again, but
yep
yeah
we're melting away here in Southeast Michigan. Definitely a lot of slush and a lot of fog, but most of the snow is gone now.
And how's your airport yard, flooded or not?
I haven't been over there. I've been putting it off.
It's not, I don't want to go over there, check, right?
Right, yeah, and then discover a bunch of problems and then have to fix it. And I'm like, yeah, if I ignore it, it's not there. So I won't have to go, you know, put down fresh straw in front of the colonies. Although, you know what? I probably should. Now that I think about it. Because in that yard, the flooding gets up to the base of the colonies. And then when they go out for cleansing flights, when it's cold like this, they don't always hit that landing board. When they're coming back down, they fall off into the water, in the cold water, and then they're just toast. So, I don't know. So
from this area, I guess it's been really atypically warm. Is it up you guys in Michigan?
Yep.
Has it? Okay. Yeah.
It's that we had a cold snap there for, it was about three weeks solid. It was just really, really Arctic cold. 8 degrees most of the time, and then we were having some, you know, minus temperatures in the evenings.
Yeah, I went to North Dakota for Christmas, and like they haven't got any snow until I guess recently, and I've never seen that before. So it's just been really warm across the whole Midwest. So I'm just curious how that's affecting your overwintering. Have they gone through the sugar stores, or have you had to supplement them a little bit?
Our one colony that I have been using to access pretty regularly for bee venom therapy. So I go in there and pull bees out, even though it's cold. So I'm actually getting into them. And they were a late season swarm that I managed to catch. And then while I was holding them for somebody to pick up, a lot of the bees went back to the nest, you know, so they had quite a few bees in there and like zero resources stored. So they weren't doing too well. But I robbed all the capped honey that they had and gave it to another colony that needed it. Cause I was like, well, I'm going to end up sacrificing this one anyway. I've probably done everything you could do to kill them, and they're holding on pretty well. And I gave them like 2.5 pounds of sugar, maybe early mid November, somewhere around there. And they're just now getting through that. And they basically have no stores. So
okay.
They've been, you know, surviving off that sugar and maybe whatever else they had tucked into the colony. So they're surprising me for sure. Yeah. When I try to kill them, I can't, but when I don't try to kill them, they die. I don't know. So you make a concerted effort to catastrophize the bee colony and they survive despite you.
I have a random question for Garett.
What type of question?
Well, it's completely random question. Like, I've been BSH testing for a while, and then we started UBO trials this year, and we had a massive overlap in our population. But some of the stuff I was finding was like 100% SMR, like it. That would allow no mite reproduction, but it didn't respond to UBO. So, like, it's kind of really making me change the way I look at the definitions of like VSH and SMR and things like that. Well, I'm gonna breed like a high SMR, low UBO line, and I was just wondering, and I have speculation of what you're gonna say, but. Like if you had both samples of both of those and you did a genomic analysis on it, could you see stark variation, or is it like we're just still feeling around in the dark because of the quantity of the genes in a genome?
Well, so you're saying if you selected one colony for high SMR and another colony for
the like a line, even not just an individual colony. I've got individual colonies that score high SMR, low UBO, and not vice versa. Usually if it's super high UBO, their SMR scores are really good too. But I was just wondering if you could compare the two of those, like if you had a distinct population that was segregated, if you could pinpoint exactly what's at play, or if it's just
So that's what we're kind of trying to do, right? So we want to find like areas where selection's happening, and so I guess just from what we're doing right now is we're comparing pole line to just like a wild type Italian population, and we're able to find like very specific regions of selection that are specifically in VSH genes, and so those are definitely genes that are under really strong selection. And so I'm guessing if you did have those distinct lines where there's variation in the trait, and we did some sequencing, we could definitely predict like which areas are under stronger selection, which ones aren't, which I think would be interesting to do that.
Same here. Just as far as breeding goes, I'm like, oh my gosh, this is insane. And yeah. I even said, I'm going to breed. I was telling Matt here, I was like, Matthew, I'm going to breed a high SMR, low UBO line. And she's like, and he goes, Kara's going to punch you in the mouth or punch you in the head, something like that. But then after I talked to her, she's like, no, I thought you would be weird about that. Like, she's interested in picking it apart too. So I was just curious, right, just because I'm going to do it anyway, because I'm doing the testing. I got the data, and I'm going to not have a day job after March of this year. So, or February of this year, probably March 1 will be my last day. So I'll just be doing breeding and bee research. And
well, so yeah, are you interested in any sequencing? Because I guess I assume that you have a really good pedigree, keep track of all your traits, or I mean, you have a pretty good pedigree compared to, I guess, most breeders.
Yep. That's and it's genetically unique, you know, like it's got influence from some breeders like Tom Glenn, you know, a little bit of VP stirred in with what I've had around here locally. And then a couple of years ago, I crossed some with John Harbo, but it's not, you know, it's been several years since I've had the last cross. And so I would suspect it would be genetically unique. And then whenever, at least to some degree, and whenever Kara tested with UBO, I checked with her again in December before to make sure I wasn't lying when I said this, but she said that our scores were unprecedented compared to what she had trialed so far. Like she tested stuff that was high, but not the amount of a population that scored high, you know, and then medium on top of that. And it was weird too, because some of our lows were 100% SMR. Yeah. So like I've got this VSH population, but there's like this divergence between the high gene element, which is, I would say, why they changed SMR to VSH. But it almost seems like SMR is not dead yet. Mm. It's like, it's different. You know what I mean?
How many of those did you end up negating when you came back and verified the queens?
Well, here's the thing, though. I told Kara what I had written on the lid for the queens whenever we tested it, but that doesn't mean those aren't the same queens. And so, like, I've got data errors in there, but one of them's a breeder queen. Like, I've seen her. I've done multiple Harbos on her. I've got SMR data on her, and then I have a zero UBO response. And that colony is still alive, so unless they superseded her late, I've still got that breeder. And
so... You know, it was interesting at the ABF. There was, you know, with the science and policy training workshop. No, I don't know. Garett, were you in there when Dr. Alger gave her presentation on the UBO?
I wasn't. So, no.
Yeah. So she had made mention about some of the tests that they had done over there in Vermont, that they wanted to come back and verify what they thought were false negatives. I want to say she was looking for false negatives.
What did she think that it was a false negative? Was it a VSH supposed B, or what do you, why would she suspect that?
So she didn't dive into it too deeply because they only, what did they have? They only had like 12 minutes to give these talks, right? I think it was 12 minutes. Yeah. So, but she had mentioned that there were some that may have had prior score. I think they did some spring vetting, and then they did it again to follow up and verify the test, and there were some false negatives, and they wanted to come back in the spring, and they wanted to come back and check them again because they feel like they should be higher because of the hygienic traits in the population, the heredity of the population as it was before they tested it should have had a higher score.
What the prior selection, though, was it freeze-killed brood, or were they already trialing UBO?
Yeah, good question. But it piqued my interest. And I was like, so we didn't get a chance to really talk a whole lot because everybody was like, you get 5 minutes with somebody and then there was something else happening. Like, it was really hard to catch up with people. And, you know, beekeepers want to just talk.
I wanted to go to that so bad, but it just was not working out.
Yeah, somebody stole your spot.
Yeah. I wanted to. I'll go this next year.
Yes, so for a test. Oh, sorry, you can go.
No, go ahead, Garett.
No, I was saying for the test that she's handing out. So are these the actual tests that they plan on selling? Like they actually sell these tests now? And then, but I guess they probably plan on tweaking the formulation a bit more. Oh, so you got it in. Cool.
Just showed up today. I had, I think it was 100 tests.
Holy smokes.
Yeah, I like to blow money, James, especially on this but it's got the applicator.
Okay.
Which is like a modified Vax gun. And then you've got
cleaning solution.
I've got several of these, and I threw all the test kits or the actual pheromone, the UBO, I put it in a freezer.
I suppose it's be stored at -20. Or does a regular freezer work?
It said just store it in a cool location. I asked her because last time, whenever we did trials, she mailed it in advance and said to throw it in the freezer.
Okay.
So I said, is freezer still best protocol? She's like, yeah, or somewhere cool. I'm like, okay. I just threw it in the freezer. Perfect. And then you've got the little test room.
Test ring. Yeah, yeah, it's pretty cool, man.
Interesting concept. It just, what struck me was just how responsive, like, our bees have been heavily VSH selected. You know, I've used VSH bees exclusively, or what was said was VSH. There's, of course, varying levels of it in different populations, but that's all I've used for the past 12 years. And then, you know, when we were in Harbo's breeding group, we just started doing VSH. Or SMR assays. James and Matthew have come down and done one with me. I usually have a group out so you can actually get some data. You know, if it's just you, it takes for freaking ever, you know, to go through all that stuff. So anyway, but I was just struck by UBO because I said before we tested it, I said, I think there's going to be a big amount of overlap with VSH because I've seen what's the right word, Matthew, or what would you call it? Not viral resistance, but
I'd say it's social immunity or social resistance.
Yep. Like if I would see deformed wing virus, I would requeen. I mean, this was back whenever I was getting Tom Glenn VSH. Harbo may have even still been at the B lab then. But if I requeened a colony that had expressed deformed wing virus and I didn't treat it, I just switched the queen out and it was successful. 100% of the time, I would come back, you know, month and a half, 2 months, whatever, after the population turned over, and I would see zero bees with deformed wing virus. It was like it happened over and over and over and over again. So I knew they had some level of resistance. I had no idea what mechanism it was or what was going on. It's just, I'm just seeing pure field observation. Sure. Well, then Cairo was saying, well, I had viral load data too. That confirmed my suspicion, you know, that my bees hadn't been treated and it was like ridiculously low levels of A and B. They rated it at BL, below quantifiable levels, and then C was none. And then Kara's data was saying, on a colony level, the viral levels are way lower. And it was a hygiene component. I'm like, there's gotta be. It's, the paths are crossing at some point. You know, yeah. Evidently there was, because you know our scores were substantial.
What was the social immunity component that was speaking here? What do you mean by that?
I think it's, well, but I see it in the SMR ones too. I don't know. My theory was is that since UBO is unhealthy brood odor, they detect that and throw them out. Which a lot of our samples in 2 hours, they cleaned our UBO samples out. Like it wasn't just uncapped, it was gone. And so my thought was, is if they have high levels of virus or an infestation, they're sick or they're stressed for some reason, that UBO or unhealthy brood odor is more apparent. And then they throw them outside before they emerge and the nurse bees are spreading herpes all over the place. Yeah, or spreading deformed wing virus just from trophallaxis. So that was
herpes,
the only
way. Herpes works fine, same way. You get it the same right. way.
But that was
tonguing all your sisters.
Right. I just thought they were throwing them out and before they could feed another bee. And it was like it was breaking the cycle somehow. Because I don't think they have, a real complex immune system. Like there's not a lot of, you know, it had to be something else, at least from my understanding of it. Anyway, I don't have a very hot, you know, that we went over it when in my master's degree in entomology, but they kind of brushed over it. But anyway, so that's
what was the price on those genomics tests that we talked about earlier last year, Garett? The lab was it they wanted up to 50 samples or was it 500 samples?
Yeah. So this is actually a test that we're talking about with ABBA. I guess you were there at ABF. And so, yeah, Corey, if you're interested in submitting samples, we can see how compared to, because we have, I guess, 96 breeders across the country, just kind of small scale breeders, and they're sending samples to us. And then we're going to compare them to our genetics that we have already. So we're going to compare it to some of these selected stocks, such as, you know, the Hilo, Kona, Poline, Saskatraz, Russian, to see if they're unique, if they're not unique. And if they're unique enough, we're going to do a really deep sampling and sequencing. So, like you said, if you're interested in, like,
I want to.
Where are you selecting at? We can do deep sequencing for that. And so I think you'd be a perfect candidate for that because you already have a pedigree, you keep track of everything, and you have a really good, like, phenotype that you're measuring. So.
And I want to segregate them. Like, I would like to label the one, assuming she's still in there. If not, I have to test again and possibly make breeders. But I want to send, like I talked about, high SMR, but no real UBO or hygiene response, which is peculiar. And then the opposite of that, okay, like a high hygiene response, and just see, compare and contrast.
Yeah, yes, yeah. So if you're interested, yeah, just collect. I guess we need at least 10 drones per colony if you want to get the queen genetics. And so just click 100% ethanol, put 10 drones in that ethanol, and it should be good forever, basically. So
I've got some of those centrifuge plastic tubes. I think that would be good to send them in.
Yeah. We also have kits we're going to send out to you. So I'll keep in touch with that. So,
okay, perfect.
Conversation. So
that's just my personal interest and my own research and curiosity. What I also would like to submit samples for, and maybe you could do the same where you might need fresh samples, is I'm getting a lot of pressure to ship to Canada. And one of the main things they wanted are for you to be clear of Africanized honeybee gene markers. And so, like, I don't know if I need to say, hey, this is specifically for this, and this is because I really want to know what's going on here, just for the sake of science.
Yeah. So it's a full disclosure with that. I mean, most of Africanized testing in the United States is mitochondrial testing, and I would not send it to that. It's not accurate at all. But the state uses it to measure Africanization, even though the accuracy is like less than 50% to 30%. So
interesting.
Yeah, it's really weird, especially like in California, for example, they actually test for Africanization. And if you're calling above a certain threshold, then they throw it out. But they use this archaic testing that was developed in the 90s that just isn't accurate at all. So it's wild. So I don't know if Missouri has something like that, but I wouldn't trust that type of testing.
Not Missouri, no. We don't even, I mean, we don't have hive registry. It's the Wild West here, which I actually like. It allows me to just do whatever I want and conduct research without, you know, having to answer to anybody, because like I said, my bees haven't been treated in, you know, over 12 years, and I don't, some people would think I would be typhoid Mary, I guess, you know.
Sending this video straight to your apiary inspector right afterwards.
But I've told people, like, I mean you guys have seen my bees. I let people come in and look at my bees if they wanted to inspect them. It's not like I wouldn't let them come and inspect them. They would be more than welcome to come and look. But I've told people too, back to that deformed wing virus thing, you know, John Kefis said something about he would pay people to find Varroa mites, and it was a very pretty menial number. Well, I've said, if you find a bee with deformed wing virus in my apiaries, I'll give you $100. A bee. And they haven't been treated in 12 years, so I think that's a testament to what, you know, actual VSH selection can do, you know, as far as measurable host resistance. Beforehand, I feel like we just felt around in the dark. Some people tried not treating, and, you know, and they're like, well, they didn't die, and maybe 2 years later they did or whatever. Yep. It just wasn't measurable. Now I feel like we can put a tape to it and go, okay, well, it's a this. You can actually see it and measure it now. That's completely different than things were. But before John turned that assay loose, or his simplified Harbo assay, nobody knew jack other than freeze-killed brood.
Yep.
But
That's different.
So that brings up some good points that I wanted to bring you guys together for, so that we could maybe, I don't know. So the idea behind hygienic behavior and like what to look for, and like what you're saying, Cory, it was kind of just random. There was no specific guidance, right? And for me personally, you know, when I first started beekeeping, people would just say, well, you know, if you want to be treatment free, or you want to, you know, go this route, or if you want to even get in the ballpark, you've got to start with good bees. You got to start with good queens. And I said, okay, but where do I get them from? And like, how do I know what it is that I'm getting? You know, and there's one or two people here or there. And again, that was the wild, wild west as well, because you call somebody up and you say, yeah, I'm looking for, you know, some treatment free queens, but what does that mean? And there's no definitional, hard, fast definition on it. It really is very subjective based on the individual you're interacting with. So treatment free queen.
You could, you know, like whenever I started and was obsessing over host resistance, you could order a Tom Glenn breeder for like the ridiculous low price of $100 bill. I mean, that's absurd. I don't know how he made money, but those were, I didn't put miticides on them, and those bees were hard to kill. Like if you were a good beekeeper, you made sure your queens weren't crapping out and you made sure they weren't starving to death. Man, they were workhorses and they just were hard to kill. But that, I think, I don't know when Harbo retired, Garrett or James may know, but at some point I feel like you can tell any stock that switches hands. You know, some people are more stuck on this or other people are more focused on whatever, but I mean, whenever they were coming from Tom Glenn back then, I think Harbo was still involved, like they were legit, you could not treat them if you wanted to and get away with it if you're a decent beekeeper. I mean, all things else considered.
Have you purchased queens of multiple sources where they market their queens as VSH to see like if they're expressing it? I think the one thing I see a lot of queen producers or queen breeders that you say that, oh, they have VSH queens, but are they actually VSH, or do they buy a VSH queen a long time ago, you know, and then
there's a lot of that. And some people say like, well, there's some VSH in it. Well, what is it, a 2? That's worthless. You know what I mean? Like there's just a tiny, tiny bit of measurable VSH in there. You're still going to have to, they're not going to be able to handle it on their own. You know, they're not suppressing mite reproduction enough to where you're not going to have to intervene, you know?
Yep. And, but see, you came into that purchasing situation with Tom Glenn with a little bit of knowledge as to what you were doing with queens. I mean, even if it was base value, imagine yourself in the situation of a new beekeeper, who's going to a club meeting, who hears the term maybe even loosely tossed around, or somebody says you need to get yourself a really good queen, or you know, if you want to be treatment free or you want to go the route of resistance, you've got to have good queens. Like where can a beekeeper find queens like that, especially like right now, even though VSH seems to have, you know, kind of hit a little bit of a trend right now, it's always kind of been there for a long time, but maybe not as prevalent. But if a beekeeper hears, okay, well, I need to get a queen, where do they get it from? Where does a beekeeper find, you know, queen honeybees? And then, you know, what are some of the things that they can ask a breeder? You know, Cory, you being a breeder, and Garett, you working with the USDA at this point in your career and having a lot of experience with genetics and, you know, having genomics as one of your soapboxes, your pet doctrines, you know, your expertise. What does somebody do to kind of figure out what is it that I'm buying? You know, like, you know, Cory, maybe you can start with that. Like, how do you determine where the queen or the mother came from? You know, what's the pedigree of the mother?
I mean, there's not a whole lot of sources that I trust that are like super, super high VSH. Like there's some that are measurable and then there's some that I have no idea about. A, because I've never measured them. I could be surprised. But, you know, there are a few that are measuring it, mainly John. John's still doing it and was selling breeding stock. I know I've heard like Robyn Underwood, whenever I was teaching instrumental insemination for her, mentioned getting some Paul line. I don't know if she had somebody at the lab collected it, if it was in, it may have been in straws already. But I mean, as far as getting bees from the USDA, like it's not like an open market per se. You know what I mean? I don't know. That's a difficult one. Like if people ask, say, I want something high VSH breeder queen, I say, talk to John Harbo. That's really the only person I recommend. But I mean, VP, you know, they've got measurable levels of VSH, but I don't know that Adam is still doing any SMR testing. I think they maybe are doing alcohol wash on the 2.2s. I don't know. Like people tell me, but I haven't asked Adam. I know Adam would tell me if I asked him because he's usually really straightforward with me on the phone. But, you know, if you don't do if you don't do VSH selection, it's like kind of like taking your hands off the wheel. You know what I mean? Like you might stay straight for a little bit, but I figure at some point you're going to kind of veer. So anyway.
Yeah, but see, that's coming into it again with a little bit of prior knowledge, right? Like, so you're coming into this, like, I've got some information and I want to ask questions based on what I know about rural sensitive hygiene. But I think maybe even more based than that, like a new beekeeper who has zero idea about any question to ask, like, you go on, I don't know, where do you go to buy queens? American Bee Journal. There's like every other page, there's an advertisement for queens. Or Bee Culture, or maybe Facebook Marketplace. There's some listings where, you know, you can go on the internet and maybe even do a Google search and find a registry where people are selling their queens and marketing their queens. But how do you know what you're getting? What's some, you know, like if I were to come frustrate you with a bunch of newbie questions, what are some of the questions you've heard, Cory?
Can
you tell me about your queens other than that they're VSH?
Yeah, that's pretty much it. And I think that's it. If you want to know what somebody has, I think you have to have a conversation with them and ask questions, because every breeder is going to value different things. You know, I've been obsessed over host resistance and basically took a path that if it doesn't have host resistance, I don't care how gentle it is. I don't care how, because it's kind of a dead end road. You know, now it's different than a lot of people look at it, but a lot of people aren't trying to correct a really pressing industry issue per se, which I wouldn't advise it most people to do, because, you know, it's close to impossible. And I think you have to be obsessed, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think as far as just general characteristics, you have to have a conversation with the breeder and you have to ask them what they value, how they would rate their bees, you know, and what they think is important, and see if that matches what you're after. Unfortunately, I think it's such the supply and the demand is so jacked up that a lot of times people just get whatever will lay eggs and shows up alive. You know, I think that's what expectation is historically. And if you know, I probably always butcher this, and I put a range in. Kara was saying like 2 to 4%. What did she say of the population? Like if it's unselected, 2 to 4% will show resistance, something like that. So I would say, if you order a subset of random queens, even if they're well-raised, nice-laying queens, good brood patterns, gentle, if you took a big cross-cut of commercial queens, probably 2 to 4% of them are going to have host resistance. But right. I've also heard a producer say, I could give a crap about hygiene or VSH. They'll even make fun of it, you know, some bigger producers. But then they'll say, I've heard them say, but if the customers want that and they're begging for it, then I love it. You know what I mean? So I also think that chattering about it or talking about it and letting people know, hey, there's not a giant supply out there, but, you know, if you start asking for it, people will probably start testing or looking for breeding stock. You know, some people aren't breeders, but they're good queen producers. You know, if they get breeding stock from somebody who's testing, they can make 30,000 queens out of it. You know, I think that's how you have to win. You have to make it worth it for the breeder and worth it to where the guys that are grinding these queens out, which is thankless work and it's really hard. You know, if you can make it worth both of those people's while, then I think you can actually get VSH in the market, you know, and people are more open to it. You know, people are talking about it and they're curious about it. So I think the market's right. Maybe it's from amitraz failing. You know, I know the USDA said, you know, we're finding pockets of amitraz resistance, and that's probably the best chemical acaricide that we have, you know, that we can use on bees at the moment. I say that there may be stuff that's equally as good. I'm speaking out of theory here, but the point is we know that all of them, eventually they get resistance to it. And so I think that faith and, or maybe it's the knowledge of knowing that, you know, those treatments, we need them and we rely on, but we rely on them too much. And we probably need to put some eggs in another basket.
Oh. Right in, so, oh, cool.
I was wondering when the first time that would happen would be.
Oh, I know. But my wife's here actually, so take care of him.
Yeah.
No, those are all really, really great points. And yeah, I'd like to follow up on that a little bit. But yeah, just from my perspective, I guess, I think a lot of people ask me, you know, where should I buy my queens? Like, that's a very common question. And the first thing I always tell them, just be really wary of where you buy your queens, because, you know, basically the bee industry, it's a wild, wild west. Like, you're allowed to market anything you want, you know? So I see in American Bee Journal, I see online, different Facebook groups that, you know, they market their queens as being VSH, or they're mite biters, or a variant of mite biters, or they're Saskatras, or these different stocks. But we don't know if that's true or not. And I'm not saying that some producers and breeders aren't maintaining those stocks. You know, they are, but it's pretty easy to lose that trade. And I will say this, at the USDA, we're really reluctant of actually giving our stocks out, because there's a whole agreement part of it, and we're really limited in the stocks that we actually have. And so when you see a pole line that's being marketed as pole line, it's probably not pole line, because we don't distribute that very often. Maybe it was pole line maybe 5 years ago, but at this point it really isn't. The only one that probably is pole line is Hilo, because Hilo is the only stock that it's a certified name, right? You can't use that name. And if you do, then there's legal action against it. So that's the only stock where they've actually, you know, certified that name, so, or trademarked that name. So if you use that, you have to actually have that stock. And that's a sort of a hybridization of both pole line and Hilo. Now, so one thing that we're trying to work at the USDA lab is, how do we actually certify some of these stocks? And so what we want to do is develop, you know, we're developing a genetic test. And so we know exactly which genetic markers are associated with the VSH, Russian. And we want to develop like a genetic test to help you certify your stock. So for example, you, Cory, you know, you can send us samples. We can say, okay, you have this percentage of VSH. So you have VSH stocks. So you can legally market that as VSH. And I think that's really needed in the industry, because, you know, I've worked a lot of different breeding programs, and I know with pole line, it's a really big issue that beekeepers are marketing their bees as VSH. And it's a really big issue in the Northwest near Purdue, because we see a lot of these mite biter stocks, mite maulers, Ohio biters, there's all these different names of it. And the reason they're calling that is because they got mite biter stocks 5 years ago, but that trade's been lost at some point, right? And so what we really need is a certification system for beekeepers, so they know that, okay, this beekeeper's marketing their stock as VSH, mite biters, Saskatras, but we need a genetic test to say, okay, this is actually stock you're buying, and certify that, because every other livestock industry has it. It's amazing. You go to the goat industry, the dairy industry, there's like a genetic test that certifies these stocks. And I think it's going to be really important going forward.
I love that you just said that, Garett. I think I heard in the background. Was it just me? Did you hear that, James, while he was talking? Yeah.
I could see the wheels turning.
Right. I completely agree, Garett, 100%. And I know, and some people are well-meaning, you know, like I've seen some people, and I like the individual really a lot, you know, and I've seen, like, once I keep chattering about, this is my conspiracy theory anyway, once I keep chattering about testing and like, hey, well, you can get it, just test it yourself and measure it. They actually took those three letters off of their description of their queens now. And like, I think it was too much of a wild, wild west for a while. And I think people just, it was a buzzword, you know, and like, yeah, it was thrown around too much of people who weren't selecting for it, you know, because selection sucks. Like, that's why I'm always critical. I'm like, yeah, if the people say they're tested, I'm like, maybe they've tested, you know, but to keep that selection pressure on it and actually breed is really difficult. Like, I heard, I think it was Jeff Harris said online, you know, about VSH a while back. They're like, he's like, basically no one's doing that. No one's measuring it and concentrating it with instrumental insemination, you know? And I was like, I have been, but he probably was like, who is that? That's BS. You know, I'm critical of anybody who says they've been selecting a lot, as I should be and as Jeff should be. Some random guy from Missouri says they're selecting, you know, but I think that'll change, especially now that we can measure it. And then even if you can measure it, you can go, oh yeah, these spreadsheets, look, you know, was a third party there? Was a skeptic like Matthew Kobe there looking at your hives, looking at your books? That's why I invited Matthew, because I knew he would be tight, and he's not going to just tell me what I want to hear because I want
to hear. He still don't believe.
Right? He's seen the nail-scarred hands.
He's so, like, yeah.
At least he's got a good picture of what's going on in my apiary, and we tested the first week of September. So, I mean, we're at peak, you know, getting towards, if it's not peak pressure. So I don't think you can hide from that. But a genomic test, it doesn't matter what you write on your spreadsheet. I feel like that's even harder to hide from. Once you've got that, you know, I'm assuming you have a pretty good idea of what's.
Yeah, no, we have very accurate markers, and that's really the best way to look at whether it be SH or not, right? I mean, even if you do the test, right, like measuring a trait is so hard. Especially for honeybees, right? Because you think about like a social trait like that, it's so hard to measure that trait. Okay. And that's why you're probably seeing a lot of variability with even the UBO test, right?
Yep.
And we see a lot of variability even with like, you know, Minnesota hygienic test, because measuring a trait is really, really difficult. But
definitely,
you know, ask that and score 6.
Because you have to look at it as like a whole colony. Well, how many different, you know, how many different paternal lines are in there? Yeah, their mother's the same, but what is there, 15, 20 possibly? So, I mean, I think you have to get the trait set to like a critical mass, or I don't know what it is, a percentage of the colony that expresses it to where it's good and measurable. You know, and some people that, like you said, had biters 5 generations ago, that trait frequency can just get so low, it's not even really
right away. Yeah, especially with mite biting. Yeah. And even with VSA, yeah, there's probably different tiers and different behaviors associated with that trait. Like, I know, especially Minnesota hygienic, right? There's like an encapping behavior. There's like your ability to actually sense the dead brood and your ability to remove it, right? So there's different behaviors involved with that, right? And so yeah. I think even with the UBO, right, it's hard to, I mean, I guess it's probably hard to target that specific behavior. And there's probably a lot of variation with that too, right? So
there is. Absolutely.
To figure out the formulation, you know? So it's a really good first step. And I think they're probably trying to test that and really pinpoint the exact pheromones, but yeah, it's,
right,
it's not easy.
Yeah, and I think Monde is working on that too. So like, I think Kara kicked a door open that's really awesome. Like, sure. Yeah. You know, we're gonna, it'll keep getting better and it'll keep getting tighter. Like they said, the hygiene test used to be 48 hours and they tightened it up, you know, and so we'll learn a lot. But I think
exactly,
I haven't heard anyone think like that before. You know, before it's freeze killed brood and pinprick and stuff like that. This is a totally next level. And it was weird too, whenever we first started UBO testing, I was like, I thought things were going great, you know, and Kara has like this concerning look on her face. I'm like, you know, I thought we were doing really good, you know, and then we got one that didn't score worth a crap, and I'm like, oh, this one sucks. She's like, thank God. I was like, what are you talking about? She's like, I thought something was wrong with the test.
Yep.
Because like we got one of my breeders right off the bat that cleaned the sample out, like a bunch of them, you know, had chewed all the heads off, and like half of them, some of them had part of one out, and I don't know, they just had a really aggressive response. But then on the flip side though, this like changes my definition of VSH and SMR. I think they're like almost two separate functions, even though they've been named the same, because I find the, you know, like I said, and this was a breeder that was a 4 on a Harbo, and somehow like doesn't, it wasn't like they had a low response, was no response to UBO. So then I start quizzing Kara. I'm like, does that stuff, because it precipitates out whenever you put it in the freezer, and then at room temp it liquefies, and I'm assuming it's like uniform, but I'm like, can that, like, yeah, are these tests super uniform? Because like that was one of my breeders that with a 4 and didn't. But then I was at, it was before it switched to North American Honeybee Expo, Hive Life, Phil, that was out with Ashby, he's like, Cory, I've got something you've got to see. He's got kind of a British accent. I'm like, okay, what is it? And he's like, look, this is a Harbo breeder, and it didn't even respond or was really low response. I'm like, get out of here. Are you serious? You know, I didn't know what to think about that. Then we tested and I'm seeing the same. So that's,
yeah,
I'm going off the deep end here, but that, this is
those are all good. Yeah. And like I said, we're still looking at the trait. So I guess as they try to pinpoint it a bit more, I think it's going to get better and better, right? You know, the first version is never the perfect version. And so as, especially with pheromones, like pheromones and trying to detect specific pheromones, a honeybee colony, that's really hard. So just to pinpoint it like to this extent already is really impressive. And so it's only going to get better. And, I'm really excited about it. And, you know, because I think I first heard about it 5 years ago when she was kind of publishing some of your work. But I mean, you think about the Minnesota hygienic test, how that really changed the industry at the time, right? Like, you think back in the 90s and 2000s, we saw chalk brood everywhere, sac brood virus, all these different diseases. It wasn't, you know, the best thing for varroa. I mean, lowered varroa levels a little bit, but it was an easy test that we could do. And it's an easy way that, I guess, a producer could verify their stock to a consumer. And totally. So it's be really important going forward.
Yes. Yeah, that's the gist of it, right? Like, you know, like you mentioned, somebody can come along and market anything that they want. And this queen is this and this queen is that, or this queen will make you 700 pounds of honey in 2 months. Matt, I think remember a conversation you and I had, and maybe I'm misremembering, but you've never bought in queens. When you started beekeeping, did you bring in queens or?
No, so I bought local bees from three different sources. I know the one source was from Gardner, so I would have an F1 from Gardner. The other guy has been running his Michigan stock for a long time, and I'm not sure about the third source. He had been a beekeeper for a long time, but I don't know if he was bringing in queens like every spring as some Michigan beekeepers do. But I do think, I mean, what you guys are saying with like with the UBO, I mean, and after Corey's talk, who was it for Cory just recently? British Columbia beekeepers, is that who?
Beastie breeders.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there was a lot of the people there were doing great citizen science that were able to get their hands on the UBO and running it through these different series of tests and really starting to. I can't think of the word, but really, really putting the UBO through the ringer, testing multiple colonies throughout the year, seeing the variation in score at different points. Somebody even had the cool idea of putting two tests, so two rings down and spraying the same frame or different frame. I didn't quite get what they were testing, but each ring had different results. So trying to just really see the variation and how consistent this test is. I think as more people have it, you know, like Kara and Phoebe are doing great research and doing as much tests as they can. But once it's equipped, everyone's equipped with it, well, then the data just starts to pour in and people start to find things and find trends. And maybe different regions have different results at various times of the year. But you can really, you know, put it through the ringer. It will be interesting to see in 1 or 2 years. Like Garett said, you know, maybe they have to modify it, maybe change the pheromone levels or maybe change the recommendation as to when to apply it or how to apply it. It will be really interesting. I do have a question for you, Garett. So the genomics, when you're looking at the genomics and you can correct me when I go wrong, because something's wrong here with my understanding, you're testing for VSH, and then you're looking at the various genomics of each colony, and the ones that are scoring high VSH, you're trying to pinpoint where on the bee genome the high-scoring ones are similar and the low-scoring ones aren't that, right? You're excluding those. But when you're doing this, what is your measure for VSH? So what are you measuring physically then that you're trying to correlate genomically? Does that make sense?
Yeah, so I actually wasn't involved with that project, but I guess what they did was they basically bred high VSH bees and they compared it to bees that had extremely low VSH. So you basically have a high low comparison, and then by sequencing the two, you can basically see okay, these colonies that have high VSH have these markers, these ones that have low VSH have these markers, and that's how they compare it. And so, I mean, that project was done at the USCB lab. So I'm not sure if they used pole line or if they used just VSH. I'm not quite sure. I'd have to ask the people at the USDA how they did that. But yeah, if it was here, then I guess it'd be the standard, I guess, Harbo test. So that's how Garett Dodds has been maintaining the stock. So yeah, I'd have to ask him a bit more. I wasn't involved in that project. I'm just doing the analysis, but
this goes back to what Cory was actually talking about then. So if that is actually, and like, you know, Cory and I have talked about the difference between SMR and VSH. So if your markers, what you're calling VSH markers, they might actually be SMR markers. Sure. And so your markers would match Cory's, but then if you had a high UBO, those markers might not be the same thing if Cory's right and that they're two different mechanisms. So yeah, that's where the semantics, like, I mean, it's actually, it's very important in my opinion, especially if they're two separate things. But yeah, and just knowing how the measure of VSH is from each person. So if I buy a queen from Cory, it's going to be, this is an SMR queen. If I buy a queen from James, who's been using UBO, you know, maybe that's a VSH queen. But it might be a separate branch pretty soon.
Well, and that's with like any of this genomic data set, like understanding the trait is the most important part, right? Like if you don't understand the trait, then identifying like a needle in a haystack is going to be nearly impossible, and your predictions aren't going to be accurate. And so understanding the trait is going to be really important. And so I don't know enough how they measure. I mean, they might be separate. I'm guessing still with the genetic test, you might be able to separate that. Maybe not as accurately as we'd like. In order to do that, I guess we have to separate those two traits if they are separate and breed sort of a hybrid to actually identify those. I do know in Europe they've been selecting for just SMR. And so we do know markers associated with SMR in Europe. But yeah, that's something we have to look into, I think, a bit more. But that's a really great observation.
Yeah. It's the cutting
Europeans
edge.
Way more discriminatory test method versus what the Harbo does, from what I can remember.
I agree. Yep.
Yeah.
And then I'll just add the last thing was there was a lot of people that were very passionate about the low varroa growth, and you know, arguably that could be something different. Like if they're just looking at low varroa growth, I mean, that could be something that's happening within the drone larva or something, where the Harbo is not looking at that. UBO is not looking at that. So if there is some mechanism like Serana or Serane that, you know, something happens with the drones and they're like, you know, just dying or super susceptible to mite parasiting. Then, you know, that could be a whole different mechanism.
Sure. And, I just explain this a bit more, right? So there's two different genomic approaches for breeding, right? There's one where you focus on just one trait. That's really hard because you need to know the specific genetics of that trait. Like VSH, we know a lot about VSH and we have a pretty good understanding of how to breed and select high versus low. And so we can make a really good marker assay for that. But for just general varroa growth, we don't know about that. But I guess from a genetics perspective, I guess it doesn't really matter what the mechanism is, right? Like basically what I'm doing, I'm just sequencing colonies that have lower varroa growth. How they get there, I don't really care, right? Whether that's mite biting, whether that's VSH, whether that's something with the brood, right? I don't really care as long as it has low varroa growth. And I'm just trying to genetics associate with that, right? So that's kind of two different approaches, right? Right. Because from a genetics perspective, you're just looking at the genetics are associated with low varroa growth. You don't care about how they get there. You know, it might not be as fast as if you do a marker-assisted approach with like VSH, but a lot of times you don't know the trait. And so that's really the best approach for a lot of these different traits, like varroa growth and like honey production. Like honey production, you're never going to pinpoint exactly the genetics associated with honey production. Right. You just have to generally say, okay, these markers are generally associated with that. And as you collect more data, it gets more and more accurate. Did that make sense?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it makes sense. So, it just sounds like we have a long ways to go yet.
Oh yeah, for sure. This is the cutting edge of science. You know, we don't have it figured out, but where we are now compared to where we were when they just figured out SMR in the late 90s is pretty crazy different. And I feel like we took a quantum leap in the past 5 years. And that's why I keep saying, I feel like that door that Kara kicked open is going to be, I mean, who knows what will come out of that one. I mean, between genomics and like getting down to response of certain, you know, pheromones, it's
we're
well, and these two approaches really complement each other, right? Because you use one approach to really, you know, kind of dig down your breeder population, and they use genomics to really filter out some of these other traits, right? Because maybe you're interested in BSH, but you're interested in, you know, some of these other viruses or some of these other diseases or some of these other, like honey production, for example. And so you can kind of simultaneously use both methods together to really get what you want and really breed bees that you're looking for as a producer.
Right. Yep. But that was my criticism. Matt was listening in on that. I caught a little bit of crap over the LVG. I was kind of poking a few holes in it, I feel like. And just because, you know, like Amy Musanti was saying, well, it's SMR and it's VSH and it's, I'm like, no, it can't be everything, you know, because I know for a fact alcohol wash data and SMR data are at odds at times. Like, and that's why I said, I think LVG, you're actually selecting for a low threshold of robbing, is my theory behind it. So I would like to see if the LVG colonies are a little heavier, or if they've got a little more stores on it and they're not triggered to rob potentially, or there's more to it than that. I feel like it can't be everything. My criticism was it was too loosely defined, or it wasn't well defined as a resistance mechanism. I think it's more a theory, a breeding theory or an approach, you know, rather than a phenomena. I don't know that it's technically if it's a phenomena and if it's heritable, I think it's not exactly what you think it is. It's going to be a robbing, low robbing threshold or something like that, where they're not bringing the little turds home, because I've seen high wash in 100% SMR queens or VSH where they completely shut down reproduction, but they've got a horde of mites coming in. Now, if you check them in the springtime, they got them back under control. But at that moment in time, when you're quantifying your alcohol wash data, it's unacceptable. It's a cull. And so you're actually culling something with measurable resistance, I feel like. And that really turns me off to the concept. But it may not be robbing. Maybe you're actually quantifying something we don't exactly know yet that's super beneficial. You know, and maybe not robbing is super beneficial as far as disease spread, etc., but it wouldn't be LVG per se. It would be low robbing threshold.
So the next trip down to your place, you know, after you get the barrel smoker, is mite washes, huh?
I have a new pellet grill that I can feed an army with right now.
There you go. So essentially, the question.
Facebook.
Oh yeah, feed an army. Well, you'll get all your assays done, hey?
It's true. We get them all done in a day.
There we go. So the question, you know, what can I ask somebody, like what can I ask a queen breeder? You basically, if we've come full circle based on all the stuff we've kind of covered just briefly, like it depends.
Most people aren't doing that though.
Right. So the answer is it depends. If I ask you for a mite resistant queen, like it depends. Like what I was asking Matt, you know, I know Matt has raised all of his own queens basically off of the stock he's originally started with.
Awesome.
You know, and you know, if you were, because he's done that, you know, since those first three colonies, right, he's got his own, basically his own kind of population going on. You know, if you were to bring queens into your circumstances now, like what are some of the questions you would want answered? You know, like what would you, because we can say, well, I want to buy mite resistant stock. So Cory, I can ask you about VSH and how you're testing using the Harbo assay or SMR. Or I can come to Garett and I say, Garett, what kind of genetic tests are you running? You know, like what kinds of data sets are you pulling off these genomic analysis, you know? Or maybe you're doing PCR and you're looking at virus load. You know, can you give me a sheet of paper that tells me the background and the history of this queen? And, you know, we've even got something new on the horizon with AFB vaccines, you know, with honeybee queens. How do you quantify that? How do I know if she's actually resistant besides what you're telling me? And so that really is the question I think that comes to mind when I'm considering buying a queen. I'm almost reluctant to even bother, because how do I trust what the person is telling me about the queen that they're providing me? And like, how are they demonstrating that?
It's trial and error.
Right. But now, like we, and during the discussion, we've covered several different means. So the Harbo assay, mm-hmm. if anybody's familiar with the, you know, the various more intensive method of SMR analysis, we're not really doing that locally as like a queen producer, but we do have something in the Harbo assay that can get us in that same realm or in direction. And we could say, well, I scored this particular colony based on this test, and this is what I got. So this is what you can know because it's what I know. Versus, you know, the idea of, well, I bought a queen breed. I bought a breeder queen last year, and then she was superseded. So she was replaced. And then I raised daughters off of her daughter. But originally that queen was VSH according to the person that sold it to me, but I never did any assays on it, but she's got a little bit of VSH. She might be a little bit mite resistant. What would you say to somebody, you know, what would you say to somebody who's bought a queen like that? Like, what should they do if they do, can they trust that that's going to be resistant to mites, or that they can maybe start a breeding, you know, program within their own apiary, or maybe even requeen a colony because they want to start trending toward that resistant stock?
I think it back to that, it depends. It depends on the individual. It depends on what they started with. It depends on if they're actually selecting, you know, or is it full open mating? Do you have instrumental insemination? And just because you have instrumental insemination doesn't mean you're the cat's PJs either, because you can make problems way faster. You can make progress way faster, and you can make problems way faster. So it, again, comes down to the skill of the breeder and the skill of the queen rearer, you know, like what methods are they using? Honestly, I think if I had all the questions and I threw them out and people like started to ask me all that, I might just go, sorry, I can't hear you. I'm just kidding. I talk to people a lot about bees, but I think overall it's good that you're raising awareness to host resistance and stuff, because I think people will start asking for it. But just as a whole, you know, most people should be aware that most queens that they're buying, even quality, well-raised queens, queen rearers that know what they're doing, you know, most of them aren't going to have host resistance. You're going to have to, I don't want to say just do it yourself, because that's the most difficult path, but talk to somebody who values it. I think that's what you should say, is not, you know, ask for all this specific information. I think you should just talk to a breeder and go, what do you hold? What traits do you hold in highest regard? And if it's temperament, they're probably going to be docile bees, you know, and it doesn't mean that they're going to have mite resistance, but, you know, you use your IPM and manage the mites, you know, like most people have. But I would just ask the breeder, what do they value in their bees? You know, what can you say about them? You know, most people aren't going to bust out spreadsheets and whatnot. And most people aren't going to nerd out to that degree like James.
Well, yeah, they just want
something good that lays eggs. And
Right. And that's usually like what happens around here, like mid season, you know, somebody's package queen will have either been replaced or superseded, and they failed at requeening, and then they're, you know, looking for a queen, and they're not looking for anything besides a queen. They just need a queen to replace the one that failed.
Does it lay eggs? Okay.
Does it lay eggs? Right. Yeah. Right. And so there's a lot of people that are going to be okay with that, and that's all that they want. And that could be an education and a value thing at the same time.
Sure.
But for somebody who's maybe moving and trending toward that, well, you know, most people say, I want to be treatment free right out the get-go. Nobody wants to treat their bees immediately. They come into the, you know, the hobby of beekeeping, and they hear about, you know, treatment free or mite resistant queens, and they're like, well, where do I get some? And somebody will come along and say, oh yeah, well, these are treatment free bees. And they get sold a bill of goods because there's no way to vet it, verify it. They lose their colony, both to poor management, maybe poor genetics, or maybe more of one than the other. And then they have this, you know, saltiness toward VSH because they got sold a bill of goods. And this might be a better question for you, Garett. You know, like if I'm looking at a specific stock, maybe it's just temperament. Like Cory said, I just want calm queens. I mean, what are the odds that I'm going to get what somebody is saying, you know, genetically? Because breeding's complex. And if anybody's got any familiarity with honeybee genetics, you can watch an hour-long video on it and you're still just perplexed, because they are they're very dynamic. There's no consistent trait that can be carried on from one generation to another. So somebody with a simpler understanding of honeybee genetics, like, what can I count on when I ask somebody for a queen and they say, well, this queen's very gentle. How much guarantee is there in that, you know?
Yeah, I guess I don't know if I put a number on it, right? Like, it's like, for any trait, there's not a guarantee at all. So I guess let's assume you're buying a mated queen, right? Maybe their docility, I guess, maybe 50% you expect that. But I mean, for most traits, I would really take everything what they say with a grain of salt, because you never know what traits they actually express until you actually get them to your operation. So, you know, I guess if you are buying, you know, queens in the North or the Midwest, they're more likely to be calmer just because there's less Africanized genetics in, you know, this part of the country, you know, whereas if you're buying queens in the Deep South, they might be more aggressive because of that. Now, that's not to say that if they do have more Africanized genetics, that they will be more aggressive, but it's a higher likelihood that they would be. But I guess I'll answer it this way. So I guess most beekeepers, I'd say about 99%, don't have the capacity or time to breed queens or even raise their own queens. And so they're just buying queens from different sources. And like Cory said, you never know. Like they could market it as VSH, you can market it as viral resistance, market it as aggression. But, you know, I would always take that with a grain of salt. And, you know, I guess you can talk to them about their breeding practices, where they get their queens from, and talk to them and build a relationship that way. But a lot of times you really don't know what you're getting until you get there. And even if you do buy a queen from them, there's a lot of different reasons for a queen to fail. It may not actually be their fault for it to fail, right? It could be poor mating, you know, poor drone quality, it can be due to a lot of different things. So, I wish I could give you a clear answer. Like, I wish I could just tell like a hobbyist, this is how you should buy it, this is what you should do, yeah. These are the guidelines. But there isn't any set guidelines at this point. I mean, hopefully eventually there will be, but it's just kind of a crapshoot at this point, you know? So, you know, I guess if you plan on being a beekeeper for the next 10 years, just kind of trial and error and find breeders and producers that you like and start working with them. Maybe buy, you know, 5 or 6 from different parts of the country and see which ones you like and go from there. That might be a really good approach. But I mean, really, I guess the 2 points of advice I typically give is, you know, what they market, always take that with a grain of salt. And then I guess 2, you know, if I were going to buy queens, I typically wouldn't buy mated queens because those are more likely to fail. I would try to buy queen cells if possible. I know it's not always likely for most beekeepers, but those queens tend to mate better. They tend to be more successful. Those queens tend to live longer than if you buy a mated queens in different parts of the country. So, you know, if I had to give advice to any person that's looking to buy queens, just be careful what you buy, and also, you know, try to buy unmated queens if possible.
Yeah. So, Garett, you've done a lot of work in commercial operations in is your undergrad studies as well as postdoc?
I still work with commercial beekeepers. Yeah, I go to North Dakota every summer and monitor about 20-30 beekeepers across the state.
And a lot of them are providing queens to the queen purchasing industry. I mean, at large, right? They're producing queens for others to purchase. They're producing queens for others to purchase, and you know, they're requeening stock to sell to other beekeepers.
So North Dakota is really unique because there's about 400 beekeepers that go to North every single summer. And so it's really all over the place. And so there's, I guess, they're really categorized into 3 major groups. The one groups are the beekeepers that go to Texas. And those are the ones that are making queen cells. They're buying queen cells, making their own queen cells. And so everything down there is just based on queen cells and mating in Texas. There's another group of beekeepers that go to California and they don't go to Texas. And those are the beekeepers that are buying the mated queens from California. They may buy a few queen cells from Texas, but typically they're buying mated queens that are mated in typically Northern California. And so, and then there's another group that actually produce their own queen cells in Texas and have, I guess, I wouldn't really call it breeding, but they have their own sort of selection process where they have some kind of criteria for selecting, albeit, you know, they're selecting on 20,000 colonies, so it's really hard, but they have their own methods for doing that. And then they raise their own queen cells that way. And so those are really the major criteria on the commercial side of it. At least I go to.
Yeah, and those are primarily focusing on production or honey production and brooding traits in their queens.
Exactly. Yep.
Even regardless of climate, that's going to be one of the top 2 criteria they're looking for.
Yeah. So grow is really important, but they also want colonies that grow really fast and are large going into almonds, because there's a sense to have larger colonies in almonds, because the price you get per colony is based on how big the colony is. And so there's kind of these two competing interests, right? Obviously, they want control of varroa, but they also want colonies that grow fast and are larger for almonds. And that was one of the biggest issues we had with pole line, right? And also with the Hilo when you try to make the hybridization. And that's one reason we actually started the Hilo program, because we wanted this mixture of this VSH-resistant line at Baton Rouge with that fast-growing large colony that's the Italian colonies in California. And that's why we made a hybridization in Hawaii, to try to get a mixture of both those traits. Because when we actually did tests with the pole line in commercial operations, they were really pleased with it because they produced less honey. They survived more, but I think there's kind of a link between like that they're making. Like they look at honey production, but they're not looking at survival, even though they're probably saving money in the long run, but they see, okay, we're producing less honey, so we don't want these queens. And so yeah, it's kind of a funny industry in that way.
But they're
Yeah.
meeting a need based on what their expectations, as well as their outcomes that they're looking for in their particular practice. They have a specific agenda when it comes to their business model.
Exactly. So I say there's different beekeepers, right? Like there are commercial beekeepers, and ones actually raise their own queen cells in Texas. Like I do see a strong trend for those being beekeepers being interested less in honey production and more into like the queen eggs and varroa defenses, right? Like we've been distributing some of our pole line stock to some of these large commercial beekeepers, you know, like 80s, for example. They manage 100,000 colonies, and so but they started getting interested in VSH, and so we're working with them, right? But there's still a faction of beekeepers that don't go to Texas and are buying queens that are interested in growth, because I guess if your colony dies, then you can just, it's pretty easy to replace them, even though it's a tough cost.
Interesting.
So that changes the dynamic of, you can't just go all in one way industry-wide. You can't just go all in another way industry-wide. The current, I guess, environment as far as sustainability is concerned is different based on the degree of beekeeping. And, 1,000 colonies has specific requirements, especially if you have a business based on what those colonies are doing and what their expectations are of production, versus someone with 50 colonies who may be more focused on queen production. They can, evaluate specific characteristics that will meet a specific need genetically, like varroa sensitive hygiene. So it's a different arena. Even though they're all beekeepers, they're focusing specifically on different things. So you can't yoke one camp with expectations from the other.
No, for sure, for sure. Yeah, because some are more focused on like nuc production and raising brood in the spring, and then queens, and some are focused primarily on pollination, where some will go to multiple pollination events in California, and then drive them up to Washington for more pollination, and then ship them all the way to North Dakota for honey production, right? And so yeah, so you're trying to kind of fit all these needs. I really do think that, if we did a demonstration project with pole line, I think beekeepers generally would be happy if they see kind of long-term results, because I think they are starting to get really frustrated seeing these 45, 50% losses every single year, so I think they're starting to realize, especially like Corey mentioned, the amateur resistance, that this isn't a sustainable treatment. I mean, I guess they're just going to go to formic acid and make their own formic acid treatments, but it, even that's not sustainable. And so genetics and breeding is the most sustainable thing we can do. And I think beekeepers are starting to realize that. And I think even the commercial beekeepers are starting to realize how important it is. And especially the ones I work with, like, so I'm primarily working with the ones in Texas, because, I guess they're newer commercial beekeepers and more receptive to this stuff. Eventually, I'll work my way to California, because a lot of them are fourth, fifth generation queen producers in California. They have their unique stock change that their granddaddy produced, right? And so I think they're less receptive to change. I think that's changing now. If I asked them 10 years ago, I think they'd be like, no way am I willing to integrate pole line to my stock. But I think they're more willing to do that now. But they have their unique Italian stock that they want to maintain, and that's, from a business perspective, that's what they want to keep. That's their brand name. So,
And it's cool that they keep that too. It would just be nice if they would, which getting, you know, getting a producer or getting somebody who's working their butt off already and then trying to add testing and data collection on top of it.
So much work. These beekeepers are unique that way, right? Like if you look at the plant industry, there's distinct sectors that focus on breeding and then the farmers focus on the growing. Beekeepers have to do everything, right? They have to do the producing, they have to do the pollination, they have to do the breeding, they have to do the queen production. Like it's just a unique industry that way. And I think that makes it even harder. Just if you are a beekeeper that manages 10,000 colonies, how do you even add breeding to that? It's really impossible, right?
Yep. Unless you married a billionaire.
Yeah, exactly. Which
I didn't do that, unfortunately.
But your question, James, like, you know, if you're a person like looking for queens, like there's so many variables. Like, I mean, you could order from the best queen producer and, you know, they ship you the best queen, but in that process, maybe the queen gets too hot. It doesn't kill the queen, but it compromises the sperm that was in the queen. And now what's arrived is a subpar queen that's probably going to get superseded or be shooting drones or whatnot. Mm-hmm. So then like to solve that variable, well, I don't want a mailed queen because I can't control what UPS or FedEx is doing with my queens. So I'm going to buy from somebody local. Okay. And you can buy it from somebody that claims that they're treatment free and that they're having success, but are they having success because of the way that they're managing their hives? Like, are they splitting it several times, you know, and never letting the colony get to a level where varroa gets out of control, and they're always kind of keeping that bee to mite ratio in check just because they're splitting at key times throughout the year, and you know, feeding them to get them up to weight. Like they can, like you can be successful treatment free by managing your colony in a specific way without having these VSH or SMR resistant traits. To some degree. But then you could also have the best genetics locally. Like I could have a Cory Stevens breeder queen. But if I don't know how to raise queens, or I'm terrible at grafting or terrible at making cell builders, well, now I have the best genetics, but I'm still producing subpar queens because I grafted the wrong larva or I have a weak cell builder. Like I know there are some people that, you know, they just have these mini mating nukes that are going constantly. They'll pull a queen out, sell that queen, let that mini mating nuke build a queen. Okay. So right there, the quality of that queen is already called in question. Yeah. And so like for somebody like me that's trying to manage all these variables. And so like when we're raising queens, we're putting cells in 5-frame nukes. Like we're letting the queen lay for 3 weeks or 4 weeks with, you know, 5 full frames of brood, really evaluating her, letting her, those ovaries develop before we even sell her to anybody. And if somebody's coming, we try to pull it the day of or the day before if they're coming in the morning, but keeping her in the cage as little as possible. And so we're doing all these things and, you know, trying to sell the best queens we can. Unfortunately, nobody asks us those questions. They just call and be like, I need a queen. Is this an Italian queen or is this a Russian queen or a Carniolan queen? To which I'm always crushing their dreams and saying, I don't know. It's a mutt. It's open mates and it's a Michigan mutt. It's all of these. I mean, if someone's selling you an Italian queen, ask them where they have Italian only drone congregation areas in the United States or Russia, you know, Russian queens are same thing. I know the Russians, they do have the genomics where they try to keep it pure, but here in Michigan, you know, I'm not sure who's going to sell you that, but there are a lot of variables. And like I said, you can have the best genetics, but be a terrible queen producer. You could order the best queen, but have unfortunate luck with UPS and you know, gets on a hot truck. There's just so many things. So I would say buying local, talk to the person that is making these queens, ask them how they're making them, you know, how long they've been doing it, you know, just some of their practices, and try to alleviate as many of the variables as possible. The problem is if you're a new beekeeper, 1 or 2 years in, you don't know all these things. Yeah. Like you don't know what you don't know. And so you're just like, you're panicking. And most of the time, like if the beekeeper didn't buy a queen, the colony will fix itself. But they go in there, they see no eggs and they panic. There's a virgin running around. And I tell them, give me a week or 2 weeks and then call me back and tell me there's no eggs and we'll go from there. But yeah, there's just I think the biggest thing, which I know what you're trying to do right now is just education, but
right.
It's just, it's, it's learning, you know, like they say, from a fire hose. It's just, it's so much to gain. But yeah, I don't know.
Both of you, Garett and Matthew, hit on a good point. Garett mentioned cells, which if you go pick them up, they never got trashed in UPS, you know, you're going to take the mating risk, but I think it's worth the trade-off. You know that she's not going to get damaged in shipping. Once she's in there, you can just leave her alone. You're not interrupting egg laying to ship her somewhere and buying local, which is what you'll have to do with cells for the most part. Some people will ship them, but, you know, if they get lost one day, they're all dead. You know, like they can be damaged. There's a lot to it. So, yeah, buying local, and I like the cell aspect too. I think that's good advice. Avoids a lot of issues.
Well, there's another theme kind of coming up too. Like if you're looking to purchase queens locally or even looking to purchase queens from somebody, maybe they're not so local and they're shipping. But, you know, it's like when you go to a farmer's market, one of the added benefits of going to the farmer's market is you get to engage with the individual and kind of get a feel for them. You know, whether they're snowing you or not, you get an opportunity to have a relationship with that individual and draw conclusions based on your interactions with them. And, you know, early on, you have to put a lot of trust in the other people that are helping you with this, you know, this whole beekeeping thing. And, you know, telling you to just go buy a queen and just keep the queen in there and, you know, keep the colony healthy, have a healthy queen and go from there is definitely one approach. But there are some things that you can do, and, you know, you can do a little bit of, you know, remedial research, you know, look up what it is you're, you know, attempting to learn about, you know, the types of queens that you want, or even the individual that you're trying to purchase queens from. You know, one of the things I learned the hard way was the treatment-free queen, you know, and putting her in the box and expecting that, you know, what the person said was, is this a queen that survives treatment-free? Great. Drop her in the box and let her do her thing. The outcome that I got wasn't necessarily, and maybe even her fault. Maybe she was the best queen that there ever was, but my management played a major role in that colony's demise, right? So it had a lot to do with management practice as well, which is another curve that you face as a beekeeper. But there are some things you can know when you're asking these questions, you know, from others and getting the information, asking people, like you said, that you trust and you know, what should I be looking for? Because then I'm going to have to just go on what you said. You said go find an F1 queen from Cory Stevens breeder stock. Okay, that's the queen you want me to go buy? All right, I'm going to go find an F1 queen. Well, what is an F1 queen? Well, how do we know what an F1 queen? Just go buy it. Don't ask any more questions. Just do what I say. Or how many times removed it? And this is the thing that comes up too, the Facebook Marketplace queen. Somebody says that they have a VSH queen that they've raised off a stock they've had for the last 10 years. What's a way that we verify if a queen is VSH? We have one simple test right now that we know for sure is easy to do, at least as far as access, is the Harbo assay. And is that person performing an assay? Or UBO was mentioned an awful lot in the beginning of the conversation. You can use the UBO test. You know, what was the score? There's data around that I can look up and I can hear from other beekeepers. This was a such and such on the UBO. Or, you know, like Garett had mentioned, you know, it's a pole line queen from the USDA. There's a lot of people out there claiming they have pole line. But when I ask them, how do we know that's a pole line? You get the same kind of response. Well, her great, 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 great grandma from the stock that my great grandfather bought back in 1982. and he started raising queen, you know, so that all gets washed out. So simply, what is an F1 queen? Corey, you kind of have your bread and butter on those.
I mean, Garett may have a better definition of it, but F stands for filial. So it's like some people look at, if I had an artificially inseminated Stevens Bee Company VSH breeder queen, that's technically an F0. I think some people call it a P0, if I'm not mistaken. And so if you graft a daughter off of that breeder queen, that daughter is an F1. And if you graft out of the F1, her daughter is an F2, ad nauseum, F3, F4, F5. You're grafting out of those subsequent filial generations, which it can, I mean, it's great for diversity, but if you're after a certain trait set, it can just be completely non-existent unless you're actually keeping selection pressure on it. So it's difficult. It's difficult.
No, that was a really good definition. Yeah. And yeah, the one thing about diversity too, right? Like, it is really great for diversity, but for breeding, what you want to do is depress diversity at those regions, right? And so I think a lot of people think that diversity is an issue in the United States, but a lot of time with breeding, like, almost diversity is the biggest problem for breeding, you know?
That is so true. Exactly. He's exactly right. And then, like, if you want to go crazy on a breeder, which they're not going to want to probably talk to you for 4 hours straight, but yeah, what kind of a breeding program are you using? Because, like Garett just mentioned, diversity and specific trait selection can be completely at odds. So, like, what I've done is run like a variation of a Page Laidlaw closed population model. So I'm testing a lot. I'm grafting out of several breeders, and I'll catch drones out of oftentimes a yard, you know, 15 to 30 colonies or whatever, out of the ones that have tested high, and I moved stuff out that didn't. And then I just homogenize all these drones. You know, could something have drifted in from a feral colony? Yes, it could have. You know, so, but overall, your trait frequency is going to be extremely high because you selected mother and father, but it's not like a single drone insemination where you sacrifice diversity at the altar to pull a certain trait out. So I feel like you're kind of, you're delaying inbreeding, but also you have a really high frequency of that trait, measurable frequency in the offspring. So it's kind of a, you know, and if you're walking into James's bees who have never been VSH selected and you're trying to find VSH out of it, well, like, back to single drone insemination, like, you can concentrate that quickly, but it's like that Tom Sowell quote that I love, there are no solutions, only trade-offs. Like, you get something, but you lost. You got VSH, but you lost diversity. So, and every breeder is going to look at it different. Every breeder, not all breeders are interested in VSH. You know, some of them are interested in other things, and that's okay. I mean, it would be boring if everybody did the same stuff, and our diversity would be gone.
So the chief question you would ask somebody you're buying a VSH queen from, specifically, we've covered like all the various traits that people look for in queens, and there's going to be folks that don't really give two rippity rips about mite resistance, and that's fine too. But as far as VSH is concerned, or mite resistance in general, because Garett, I think you said it pretty, you know, aptly, like, it doesn't matter if it's low varroa growth, if it's UBO, if it's Harbo, if they're suppressing mite reproduction in whatever capacity that they are, and that trait's been sequentially selected for, and it's becoming a dominant trait in a particular population. What are some questions you would want to ask somebody who's saying, I've got mite resistant stock? How can I have a vote of confidence, not a guarantee, right? But a vote of confidence that I'm going to have higher odds of propagating that particular genetic in this colony once I purchase this queen.
I would ask them what line, you know, was it a Hilo or was it a Pauline or was it Adams 2.2 or was it a Harbo breeder? You know, like, what are you grafting off of? Or was it a daughter? You know, if it's open mating, and they aren't selecting, you know, the traits could be all over the place, but they could tell you, you know, if it was off of a, if it, like, oh, this is a Harbo F1. Well, you know, that's going to be an SMR queen for sure.
Well, then also, also with the F1s, right? Like, if, you know, even if you're buying an F1 and that F1's open mated, you still lost like a good portion of that, those genetics. And yep. So, I mean, even if they are claiming that they have VSHBs and you're buying F1, you've already lost like a good portion of genetics. And so that's a really important thing to consider. And so if you are really interested in, you know, VSH, I mean, I try to buy like a parental, right? Like an F0, I guess, like from Cory or somebody else. I mean, they're expensive. I don't know how much you charge, but they can be around $3,000. But if you're really interested in that, maintaining that, that's probably the best route. Unless you want to buy an F1 and then do your own selection that way. But if you want to start with the best stock, that's the best approach.
Right.
But what's the best part of the F1, Garett? This is your forte. What's the best part of the F1?
Well,
What's coming out of that F1 genetically?
Yeah, well, I mean, the genetics are coming from the queen part of it, and I think people get really focused, like, where do the genetics come from? Like, it doesn't really matter. The genetics are coming from either the males or the queens, but the queens is one way that's easy for a beekeeper to maintain that. Now, if you have, like, a really isolated area, or if you're able to just kind of flood your area with drones, like, that's a really good approach. Like, you could do that. You could buy a bunch of F1s, have some of them produce a bunch of drones to try to flood the area. We don't know the best method to do that, but it's been successful for some people. So that's one way to maintain that trait. But still, like, you're still risking the open mating, and most areas aren't that isolated. So you're always going to lose that trait unless you're consistently selecting for that trait, consistently evaluating for that trait. And you have to have some semblance of closed mating if you really want that trait to be expressed. Because, like I said, you buy a queen from Cory, like an F1, and I mean, he's obviously has a really great breeding program. It's like for VSH, but it's not going to be the same as the queens that he's seeing, right? It's in a, you know, VSH can be different in the colonies that queens that you're buying.
Yep, because it'll be a 50-50 blend, because I don't sell open mated. I just do cells or virgin queens. But back to Garett touched on it a bit. If you're actually selecting, if you're using instrumental insemination, so if you have a Harbo or a Stevens Bee Company breeder, and you raise 1,000 F1s, and you requeen your colonies with it. Well, if they actually did the selection, and they did instrumental insemination, all those drones should carry that trait set, because they're unfertilized. So it'll be, you know, they don't have a father, only a grandfather. It's not an exact clone of their mother's DNA. It's a recombinated set, but they should carry it. So you could, you know, you'd want to go heavy, you know, get a bunch of F1s and put them in whatever mating yards or satellite apiaries or whatever scheme you're wanting to use. You know, you could weight the average of open mating. And if you weight the average of open mating, and this is what Garett keeps saying over and over, and I 100% agree with, actually select, this is the hard part. I mean, you could potentially keep that. You know, I think some of Marlo's work with some of the commercial people up in Minnesota, it was all open mating, but they were actually selecting.
Yep.
You know, it showed that they could keep the trait frequency high enough that it was effective, but you have to select. If you let off the same thing, if you let off the steering wheel, you know, you'll stay in the land for a little bit until you hit a pole.
Yep. Well, and I'm really glad you brought Marla up too, because even in Northern California, because we did genetic the hygienic testing with them for the Bee Informed Partnership, and all the beekeepers were doing testing for it. And so even though they were doing open mating, they saw like drastic improvement in the trait, because all the drones are carrying that allele, yes, that marker, for example, right? And so open mating can be really successful, but it's really hard. So you either need to be in an isolated area, or you need buy-in from all the other beekeepers, which is going to be nearly impossible. Yeah. A lot of cases.
Exactly. But if you're getting F1s, that is something to ponder, especially if you're wanting to fix a certain trait in your population. Don't just get one. Yeah. Obviously, you're going to want to buy boxes of them and queen a bunch of your colonies with it. You know, and like a lot of my swarms around here, I'll catch that are feral. So they weren't out of my bees, but obviously they're close enough to interbreed. And I've tested swarms that were carried the trait to a really high degree. But I mean, who would have thought? I've been here for a decade and all my colonies are just shooting drones out all year long. Of course, it's going to fix in the population. You know, and the same could be from someone else. If you're buying cells, you know, I know like Mixa down in Florida, they're the masters of shipping large quantities of queen cells, and they keep cool breeding stock too. So you could always call Andy or Ted and ask them what breeders they've got out of. And if it's something you're wanting, you know, you could stick that in your population, but if you're not selecting for it, you need to just keep buying it and support the people that are actually selecting, because that's the grunt work.
Yeah. So if you can't necessarily do that, but you still want to participate in it, I mean, it would be best practice to bring in stock from somebody who's vetting their bees and doing the legwork. And maybe you've got a couple of commercial operations within the vicinity of your particular, you know, bee yard. You're just a hobbyist, but they're definitely, you know, putting more drones out than you are or ever will, can't, you know, until
until you form a co-op and you're able to combat the numbers. But in regard to that, you can still bring in stock and you can still be looking for those characteristics in the stock that you bring in and then propagating from that within your own colonies.
Well, just if you're actually testing, like Garett said, if you're grafting out of those mother queens that are actually tested, then the drones out of those progeny are more predictable too. And if there's commercial guys close to you, most of those guys are going to want to keep something that's productive. So, you know, you might get some extremely good blends if you're weighting the average on that mite resistant, but then you've got that productive commercial influence as well. And who knows, they may be running Paul lines or something.
Right.
You could always
ask them.
Yeah, strike a conversation.
Phoebe and Kira presented some pretty encouraging data where they had the high scoring UBOs and the low scoring UBOs, and then they took queens and they swapped them and have them got mated in the different mating yards. And it seemed that both the mother queen, even if she had high UBO and they had a daughter that was mated in a low UBO yard, they still had a pretty high degree of UBO, so that the drones weren't really drowning it out that first round, the F1 round. It would have been cool to see if they continued to do it F1, F2, and see how long before it was flushed out. And then I didn't catch, I know one of them mentioned it and I just wasn't paying attention. The low F1 queen mated in the high drone mating yard, high UBO right. drone. I didn't catch if that also scored relatively high or like if the drones had just as much impact as the queen's genetics or not. Did any of you guys catch it?
No, I'm sure it has a big impact, though. It's just less predictable if it's open, you know, because you can't say for sure that someone's not close to you or, you know, right. Still interesting data, though. But I think some of John Harbo's original work, too, said that in the F1, this isn't F2, F3, et cetera, but if it mates with unrelated stock, that F1 is going to have us, the way I understood it, strong measurable host resistance. Even though it outcrossed, it still should be a mite-resistant colony. Now, like Garett said, if you're grafting out of F2s, F3s, et cetera, and you're not selecting, that's the thing. It depends. Are you selecting? If you're selecting, you know, that's different. If you're not selecting, you could probably completely lose it, you know, after several generations.
I actually have the slide right here, I think.
Oh, man.
Aren't you excited, Matt? I could tell.
I do. My prediction was that the F1 queen from the high UBO mother had a more predominant or more consistent higher score on the UBO than what was impacted with the drones. Yeah, that one. This is on the SBGMI page.
This is not uploaded yet. No.
Okay.
But this is the average UBO score in the high apiary was 85%. The average score in the low apiary was 29%.
That's pretty impressive. And
but they could still have some SMR though, right, Corey? The low scoring.
This is true.
Okay, so
they weren't, but they weren't testing for it, right? They weren't.
For it, it's probably not going to happen. This was unique to my population that was high VSH selected. I'm going to say their low is probably not SMR tested bees.
So then, this was the hygiene score of the mating apiaries. So they were still. What's that?
It definitely had an impact.
Yeah, and so that was the first generation. I mean, that gives a little bit of hope, right? Phoebe's gonna love that shot of herself right there in the corner. We'll leave that there for a little while.
Really good one. But that data just says exactly what Garett said earlier, though. If you're not selecting, you know, if you are selecting, even if you're open mating, you can raise the frequency or keep the frequency high or reasonably high, but if you're not selecting at all,
right, it's not hopeless. It's just a trek uphill.
Exactly. It's gonna be slower progress. Exactly. Yep.
And you might have to bring in an F1 every, you know, couple of year, or a round of F1s every couple of years. If you're not seeing progress, or you start losing it in the stock that you're running, you know, but if, like you're hinting at, if there's a whole network of people doing this within your area, then hopefully, I mean, you guys can help flood the drone yards, but if your stock starts to get low, you can tap into somebody else, because the incentive for them is to continue to keep these drone congregation areas packed full of BSH drones as well. So,
and I'm quitting my day job, so I would strongly encourage the purchasing of F1.
StevensBeeCo.com/
shameless plug there. But yeah,
that should be the name of your new podcast, Shameless Plug.
I don't know about that.
We need to get special queen markers for them, right? Like every queen that you sell, a special marker on top of them.
That would be pretty cool. I know Dan Purvis had like these cool little. Did you ever see that, James? Was that before your beekeeping time?
His before me.
Queens, he had like these little custom discs made with his little logo on it and stuff. It was. Oh, he was awesome. Ahead of his time.
That's fancy. That's like having spinners on your beater car that don't run out in the front yard.
Exactly.
Yeah, it looks good, but it don't run.
Corey, I always say, go ahead.
I was just going to say, once you put a numbered disc or a cool disc on her back, the price goes up exponentially. But I always roll my eyes and people are like, how do I catch this queen and put a disc on it? I'm like,
it's fine. Yeah.
I mean, you can do that, I suppose, if you wanted to track them. But to me, a disc is a inseminated queen, and a dot is an open-mated queen. So, I mean, I'm sure you could shist people that it's an inseminated breeder and tag it. But really, that's the thing, is whenever you're inseminating it, you're knocking them out. And so you don't have to catch them and chase them. You know, they're anesthetized whenever you apply the disc and give them a clip. But yeah, open mated queen should be paint dotted.
I agree. Yep. I agree.
But I'm a purist. Yeah,
you don't want to see me trying to catch queens.
You have one of those queen catchers, those little cages you buy from Man Lake.
Yeah.
The clips, the hair clips. Yeah, I will use those on occasion. I've gotten much better at just grabbing them. But it reminds me of a story. Somebody came to purchase a queen, and I like to leave them in the nuke until they get here, right? Like, I don't like to cage them prematurely. I have time to pull them when they get here. But this definitely caused the individual concern with my ability to produce a good product, because she started flying all over the yard. And so I'm chasing her around the yard, and finally I catch her. I've got her, right? And, like, Corey and Matt are very familiar with my bee yard dancing. I'm dancing with this queen in here, and I try to run into the office where I'm sitting now. I'm like, okay, let's get her in a place where there's walls, you know? Like, and so the guy, he's following me, and he's just like, what do we do? And I'm like, help me catch her. Yeah. So she finds a way out of my hand. Now she's flying around the room, just buzzing around. I'm like, dude, this queen is mated, and she is like taking off like a bat out of hell. It was just unreal.
They will do that. Yeah,
she's still alive, for what it's worth. She actually made it through her second season. So
nice.
It was just another selection test. Can I survive James catching me?
Yes, this is one of the grading criteria that I see. It's different for everybody. If you can survive my bee yard dancing, then you make it through the program.
So one of the other things, like, you know, obviously I'm super skeptical and of all things.
No.
So, like, for the breeders, right? So I think, and this is a good question, I think, for Corey, how often have you scored an inseminated breeder on the Harbo scale and it not got a 4? Like, do you ever get ones that are 3s? Have you ever got one that was 2, or one that's just like, what the heck happened here?
It was whenever I first started measuring it. Now, you have to take into account, I got whatever VSH I could get my hands on exclusively. And then whenever I was in John's group, I started testing everything. So yeah, earlier on, you know, I would get a lower score on some breeders even, but it was unique to that line. I felt like it's not like, you know, if I'm testing everything and I'm using the methods that I'm using now, I don't get as many surprises as I did earlier. You know, earlier, I think it was just because some of the stuff I wasn't getting didn't have high measurable levels of it.
So I just think that's another important question that somebody could ask was, like, it has the breeder been scored? Because it, I don't think it's a good assumption to assume, yeah, here's a bunch of F1s from this breeder, but the breeder has never been verified that it's actually indeed a four. And then I would feel bad. Like, I just sold a bunch of F1s to these people and, oh, it turns out this breeder, you know, was a one or a two, you know, and you're charging a premium. So I do think it's important for the person that is in possession of the breeder just to verify that, yes, this insemination went well and we have that trait that we're selling.
I would agree. And also that's why I became isolationist. Like, I kept buying VSH, you know, like, oh, I need more. I'd get this VSH line or I'd get VSH from here because I couldn't measure it. Like, nobody had said anything about it. So I was just like hoarding whatever I thought was VSH. So I had a lot of unique diversity in my pool. And until John showed us how to score it, it's like somebody pulled a mask off my eyes. I can actually see what's going on now. Oh, okay. That's whenever I'm like, okay, I'm not bringing in anything else. And I'm just working with this population in a closed, you know, a Paige Laidlaw variant, I would call it, to where I'm just constantly molding this population. I'm not bringing in anything else for an outcross. The last outcross I did was with John's bees. But
I think that kind of begs the question a little bit too, like, John Chambers from the UK, I think is his name. Is he a professor or researcher? I'm not sure. But he had discussed the basic, you know, honeybee breeding genetics and something as simple as temperament. And there's actually, I think, a lot of data that supports this and some studies that I had reviewed in the past was that something as simple as temperament actually is probably harder to breed for or as hard to breed for as resistance and washes out just as quickly, like within a few generations, like that, like temperament can wash out by time you get to the third generation. The genetic diversity within the honeybee population actually reverts it back to the norm after subsequent mating. So like, no matter what you're doing, you have to consistently be focusing on that trajectory with that population till it becomes fixed. And then once it's fixed,
what's selection, that? It goes right back to selection pressure. Like, you have to keep the selection pressure on it.
That one's easy to select for.
Yeah.
You don't have to do anything besides, oh, they suck, they're done.
Yeah, these ones are stinging me. These ones got to go.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yep.
These ones make me dance in the bee yard. Not happening.
Even color isn't just like a gene, I don't think. Like, I think there's several different genes involved. Like, and I don't have really dark colored bees, but Megan Mahoney was saying, like, try just selecting for black and see. You know, it's difficult.
Although I had my yard, I had been kind of selecting for that, dark bees, just because I like them. And this past year, for whatever reason, I don't know if it's because of what I'm surrounded by, but it was a lot of blonde queens.
Yeah.
Which was very interesting. Megan, my wife, was very excited because she likes the blonde Italian looking queens. They're easier to find and she just likes them. But anyway, it was interesting. Like, I even had the small yard where I had purposely selected all my dark queens. I was starting a new yard. And we split them in the spring. And I think I only ended up with one that was actually like black. The rest of them were all blonde or tiger striped, and it just kind of reverted back. So my assumption is that there's somebody else out there that has a lot of blonde bees. But
yeah. Well, I've had blonde since like whenever I first started ordering Tom Glenn VSH Italian. I had some of the original Pauline breeders too. Everything was blonde. And then like the last cross I did with Harbo, he said he doesn't select for color. He's just selecting for SMR, for BSH. So I got variation And then, like I said, I'm isolationist. I'm not bringing anything else in. It was like a rubber band. Choop! It snaps right back, and all my queens are like that to lighter colored. Like they're all Italian-ish. If people ask me what my bees are, I'm like, I don't know. They're Italian-ish. Just, I mean,
ish.
The thing is like they're more responsive to nectar and pollen shutting off. Like I've had some Italians that just will brood themselves to death because there's no stores coming in. These aren't like that. Like they'll shut off, but they're not a carny, obviously, you know? So I don't know. They're just,
we have your F1 next to one of our darker queens, and just going from the dark colony to your colony when we're doing inspections, I mean, it's drastic. I tried to catch it on camera, but camera really doesn't do it justice. But yeah, when you popped it, you're like, oh yep, this is Corey's, you know.
Totally. And I've got one of Troy Hall's breeders that he used this last year. He sent it to me for testing because I'm wanting to work on a dark VSH line too, but I don't have anything. And so like Troy's stuff didn't test too bad last batch he sent me. And so I'm going to start with some of his. And if you walk down the line, it's the same way. Like, whoa.
Yeah.
They're a little bit more dark compared to mine. And I noticed the other day too, it was cold. And that my bees were moving around a little bit, and I walked by Troy's. They thought they were in South Florida. They're like, coming and going. So, like, they'll work at a lower temperature. But, I mean, he's in New Hampshire, so I would expect them to.
That's cool, though. You get to witness that variation.
Absolutely. So we're working on a northern, cold, hardy, dark, matte line of bees. But who knows how long it'll take me.
Or if it will stick because you have so many blondes running around there.
Well, I'll probably isolate them. They'll probably have to go elsewhere. I don't want to just mix them up too much. I mean, I'll be using inseminations, but still, it's easier just to. It's like I was saying, whenever I'm catching out of a bunch of colonies that score high, I like to move the ones out that don't, because I'm sure you have some level of drone drift going on. And I'm catching them free flying, which is kind of a drawback as far as accountability of where they came from. But if I'm the only, if only my hives are around, I'm less concerned with it. But the trade-off is they just went out and took a giant poop. So whenever I'm extracting them, I have way less chance of contamination, and the drones aren't disgusting, which I learned from Sue Kobe in 2014, and that's how she does it too. She lets them fly and poop and then catches them. I say lock the door whenever they're coming back from the singles bar. The door is locked.
What were you going to say, Garett?
No, I totally agree. Yeah, that's how I typically do it too. Yeah, it's just easier when they're flying. Because if you like cage them up into a colony, and even if you make like a flake cage, like, they're so little poopy, and it's hard to work with you. Yeah.
Yeah,
well, it will be cool to see what color combinations you come up with the instrumental insemination. So dark drones, dark queens, the assumption being that it's going to be dark. It will be interesting if that's not the case.
I think it's going to be all over the place, because some of my light queens will make a darker drone too, you know. So I told Troy, I'm like, I don't know what to do other than graft out of your queen. I can, if they have a big drone population, I could self some of them, like, you know, breed a daughter to, you know, the drones that are coming out of that colony. That's one way to keep it. But I think I'm going to segregate out the stuff that I have tested, you know, high UBO colonies, segregated out, and just, you know, color code them, where I'm just getting the dark ones and cross that back with Troy's and see what's happened. I mean, I don't know. I have no idea. It'll just be a fun experiment.
That's the other beautiful thing about the bees, right? And it's just, everything is ever changing and never consistent. And there's always some sort of new challenge around the corner, regardless of what it is that you're doing, whether it be inseminating or open mating, or, you know, like there's just all these variations that keep us engaged with them. But, you know, from a positive selection standpoint, we have to have our eyes open. And especially if you're in queen, you're queen producing queens for others, having some sort of a protocol in place that you can help communicate to them what it is that they're getting. Because more and more people are making decisions based on what we're telling them. And these are the traits that I selected for. And this is what you can't guarantee that you're going to get, but you can expect. And, you know, like all the way back to when I first bought that first treatment free queen,
if I asked a question of that provider, what can I expect? The only thing he could tell me is the mother survived multiple winters without treatments. And then, you know, that begs a whole other list of questions, like what kinds of treatments, what is your definition of treatment free, and do you do brood breaks and splits, are you bringing in Africanized genetics from Texas, you know, like what are all these different things that you're doing that quantifies what treatment free is. But the one thing we truly can know is that there is a way to measure resistance as far as what we know as VSH and SMR is concerned, and we can use the Harbo scale to determine that. And we can also communicate what others are getting based on that. So the USDA uses this as a measure, right, Garett? And then Cory Stevens uses this as a measure. And there's other breeders out there that are using these as a measure. So this is one thing that we can look to say, yeah, we can measure and quantify that somebody scaled that particular queen and her offspring. And here's what you can expect from, you know, the F1 generation and the F2 generation, but you still need to test. And if you're planning on breeding off of that queen, you should test further, right?
Yep. Whenever I was at the USDA lab and I talked to Frank a little bit, he had said something, and maybe it was just an idea. I don't know how far along it's advanced, but he said something in a local bee meeting where I said they mentioned me and he wanted me to come out to contact him and visit the bee lab. He was talking about basically like a program that kind of has some accountability and testing to it. I don't know if it was just an idea or if he's got funding behind it. I don't know. I don't know if it was in the dream state or if it's moving, but that would be really cool to see. I mean, it was really
like you awesome. Were dreaming or Frank was dreaming?
No, Frank said it. I just showed up.
Okay. Oh, yeah. So you weren't dreaming about Frank.
I was just cheerleading. This was Frank's dream. So I don't know.
Yeah, certification, yeah. So we are working on the certification for I guess VSH and pole line. We already have the developer for Russian, but that's sort of the next stage. So I think it's getting pretty close couple of weeks.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Because whenever you said that earlier about having kind of some accountability or a protocol or a structure, and he talked about like cattle, how they have Angus Cattle Association or Charlet cattle, and they can test for that stuff, like. Man, that would be super cool to see that come to the bee industry.
But I also with the bee industry, right? Like, I guess like they're marketing that because there's definitely a market from the consumers. But I also think the producers want that stock. And like, you know, I guess you do the breeding, right? You understand how hard it is to run a breeding program. It's complicated.
Yeah.
So I think like one of the major challenges is like, how do we get these stocks out to these people, right? I mean, not everybody has the potential or the time or the money or the infrastructure to actually do a breeding program for VSH. So how can we help them get the stock out to them? And so I think one of the major challenges for us at the USCB lab and some of these other stocks, right? Like at Purdue, right? We bred this like mite biter behavior, but the problem is always getting out to the general population. I think it's really hard, right? You almost need university or the USC to breed these selected stocks and then have like breeders like yourself maintain them and distribute that. But there's always like there's always some kind of chink in the chain, right? Like even the Russian breeders, I think a lot of people want the Russian breeders, but there's not enough of them to produce enough queens for all the people that want them, right? And so there's these like limitations in the system. And so I think a lot of ways, like it's pretty easy to raise real resistant bees. The biggest issue is like how to get that out to the general public, right? And that's what I tell a lot of people, like we can breed resistant bees, whether that's mite biting, whether that's VSH, but like how the heck do we get these out to the beekeepers? It's hard.
Exactly. And then like it's, you know, you start to look at markets and you go off the deep end with that markets and profitability, like a lot of bee breeding books in the past, you know, they'll basically say, it's gotta be done. Somebody's got to breed a better bee, you know, and which is, breeders are a small percentage of beekeepers. And then they'll follow up with, but there's really no monetary incentive to do so. So I think that once the demand seems to be picking up, it has to equate to dollars to the people that are doing the work to make it worth their while to, you know, like it's complicated. It's not so much, like you said, we can breed or we can come up with something that's resistant. It's just, it's all the logistics and, you know, you've got different skill levels involved too. Like there's no unit of measure. That's starting to change. So I think that's where the USDA could play a big role of just saying, look, we'll test your stuff and tell you, you know, give you a score or maybe say, here's a list of breeders that are, you know, and then maybe they could work out deals with large producers, because that's the only way to saturate the market is these right. large producers to use those breeders.
Yep.
But
yeah,
the market's definitely growing.
Go ahead.
No, go. You can finish your thought.
No, mine might derail this train.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, one of my goals is, like, you know, we can breed these stocks, but yeah, how can we have like different satellite breeders? And so I guess I would ask you, Cory. I mean, I guess you, like, your queens are probably in high demand, right? Because you're kind of a well-known name. You give a lot of talks. Like, how many people are constantly asking you for your breeder queens? And like, how many Cory Stevens would we need to the previous age and maintain the stock? Because at the USDA, right, we've had a high demand. I think people are realizing that we can't just give out stock, right? Like, how many USDAs do we need to maintain this, right? And it costs a lot of money to actually maintain the stock. So do we need like 50, 100 of these breeders? I don't know. And that's going to be a major challenge, I think. That's where the chink is in the armor.
Absolutely. Yeah, you hit the nail on the head. I don't know how many are involved. It kind of depends. Like, and it's such a unique skill set too, you know. And then coming at it from my side, like, I've been funded because I've had a day job and I've just slowly built this business, but like, it's just obsession. You know what I mean? Because there for a while, I think my wife thought I was losing it just because I wouldn't let go of it. You know, and monetarily it didn't make sense to keep doing it, but I just didn't stop, you know, and then it kept getting better and better and better. And then Harbo taught me how to measure it, and I already had instrumental insemination in place. Like, I don't know. And I don't know that you can just say, oh, well, so-and-so is interested in that. They wrote a nice grant too. We'll give them some money. You're going to have such an amazing rate of attrition. You know, I don't know that you can come at it that way either. And selling breeder queens, you know, unless they're like in the, like WSU was selling them $2,500 to $3,000 range, they're not really worth selling, unfortunately, because it kind of handicaps your breeding program. You want as many as possible. But then if you start selling them for a couple $100 or $500, you know, Tom was selling them for $100 and they were laying and they were phenomenal. Like, he had to work like he didn't need the money, you know, I'm assuming. Or John Harbo, he's retired, so, you know, I'm sure he gets a decent pension check and he just loves doing it and wants to make a bit of money. But there's no way to build a business like that, I don't think. The only thing that got me out of my day job was convincing people that I had a decent method to introduce virgins, which I hadn't heard anywhere else, and that I was producing, that I was doing the grunt work, that I was doing the measurement and producing quality stock. It was those two factors. Oops. And virgin sales is what got me out of my day job. It wasn't breeders or nukes or honey or any of that, which is odd, I would say. So I don't know. I don't have an answer to any of those questions.
No, that's really the biggest issue, like, before time, right? Like, I can talk about genomics and breeding, but it's always to go back to that issue we've had for the last 50, 60 years. So it's just, yeah, it's just a systematic issue that, yeah, I think we have to figure out how to address. And so I don't quite know how to do that, right? Something with the brainstorm.
I've got some ideas. I don't really want to say it out loud in case it doesn't work, or I don't know. I'm always typically just an open book about what I'm doing, but I think that if it does work, people will figure it out soon enough, and then other people are going to do the same thing, you know. But I think it's not without issues, but I think I've got a solution to that, and it may address mass availability of open mated queens and actually make it worth my while as a breeder to maintain the stock and do the testing too.
So you're cloning yourself.
No.
Oh, wow. So no, only just one Cory, no, not multiple Corys.
Yeah, it's basically, so, I want to try to make it worth their while, because I think they're offering a premium product, so it's obviously going to pull the price change, but I'm also trying to make it worth my while as well, so we'll see.
After
but at the end of the day, the market is there, and if the Russian breeding program is of any relevance, an example, right, that you cannot get Russian breeder queens
primarily from them because they can't keep up with the demand for their first generation queens for the people that are in their program.
I mean, breeders are expensive, man. If you're doing all the selection work and any genomic stuff, holy crap.
But they can't even keep up with the F1s.
Right.
So the demand for the F1s are there, and they can't keep up with that.
Right.
And so why would like you mentioned, sell
a breeder for a couple hundred bucks?
Right.
Give someone the right to make 20,000 of those queens for a couple hundred bucks. You know, that doesn't make sense necessarily.
But that's another demonstration of what you were saying. Like, there's not enough people doing it. Like Garett had said, how do, like, what does that look like? You know, like,
if you figure that out, and you get and you figure out the profit, and you figure out the logistics, though, and then you share that, it's on.
Yeah. Well, what's their bottleneck? Their bottleneck's not grafting. Their bottleneck is criteria. The people who are doing it, meeting the criteria to produce the stock.
Well, the breeders that have the expertise and the time to do the quantification aren't open-mated queen producers. And open-mated queen producers are so busy and working so hard, they don't have time to do the quantification. So it has to be a symbiotic relationship or it just falls apart. And that's why I was saying it has to be worth the producer. They need to make a little bit more for their money. But this would plug directly into what Frank was talking about, the VSH. If the USDA says, hey, we can guarantee we've done the testing, here's your people. And then I think if they follow what I'll talk more about it once it's moving and I feel like it's actually going to work. And then I think it's going to work out. Now there's an element of trust involved and whatnot too, but you know, if you're a solid person, you're doing the work and you're forthright, I think it's going to work out.
You say there's demand and the certification, the supply dramatically decreases, right? And so that changes the equation a little bit, right? If a person wants VSH because it's really well known now, this is a stock that people want, and that supplies a dramatically decreased certification, and so that's going to incentivize maybe more people to get into breeding because you can market that as a higher price because of that, because you know that you are getting that exact stock, which goes back to our beginning question, like, how do you know what you're getting? This is one of the only ways, unless you actually know the breeding and the breeder.
Yep, exactly. That's what it comes down to. And like what James was asking about earlier, you know, like what questions do you ask your breeder? Get to know them as an individual and see what they value. Because everybody
go assay their stock. Go to their house and test their stock yourself.
Secret sent them. Yeah, send them to me. I'll test them for you.
There you go. I'm definitely going to be sending Garett samples. And, you know, I think, Matt, you talked about coming down to test again potentially this spring, right? I've still got your mead bottles.
But no, my question though for you guys is, so the certification process, it makes sense for Cory, like as from a business perspective, but is there any concern? So much like how we're really reliant on Amitraz, and Amitraz is kind of failing, if we have the certification process where we've identified these few alleles, you know, we know there could be a bunch out there, but we know these five exist, let's just say. And now everyone is just testing for these five alleles, and we're putting all of our eggs in the basket of these five alleles at the expense of other potential traits that could have developed, but we keep selecting against that because we keep selecting for these alleles, and everybody's going to buy into like the certification because we need these, you know, that could be a little bit dangerous too. If we just like stop breeding or stop the selection process because we feel comfortable with the ones that we have. We don't know what we don't know. We don't know what's out there. There could be something better out there. But if we start the certification process that, you know, everyone's buying into, is that going to impede other breeders or, you know, other people from selecting from potentially a better stock, you know?
I don't think it will. I don't think beekeepers can even agree on screen versus solid bottoms, how they would agree on a trait set. You might have a critical mass. But that's a positive thing. If the critical mass is putting that gene set or those certain alleles into the population as a whole, and it starts to level out, you know, then you kind of won the game. So I don't know that. I mean, there's always a trade-off, but I feel like the fact that no one was selecting for any kind of host resistance on a commercial level, that's a massive win. I would take a little bit of trade-off. But I also think that people like me, is if everybody's selecting for VSH, they're going to do something different just because that's everybody else is doing the same thing. And same with academics, because they'll say, that's old news. We need new research. I want my claim to fame. I'm going to find something else in here. So I don't think it'll ever get stale. I mean, no. I guess, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But if you know, if, oh, go ahead, Garett.
Oh, I mean, that's one more point, yeah. And with these genetic tests, right, like, you know, eventually it'll be more personalized, like, based on your interest, right? Maybe you're interested in VSH, but also from research perspective, right? And, like, you want to not only decrease genetic diversity at those sites where VSH is, right? Those, maybe those, you know, 500 alleles, but you also want to consider genetic diversity at different sites because you want to have, like, you want to not only select for these regions, but you want to conserve genetic diversity. And so these chips will be designed to do that. And but that'll definitely take some time, but that's something we need to keep a track of. But also drone fertility is going to be a big part of that too, because we know that if we select for VSH or some of these rural defense behaviors, drone fertility goes down. And that's something we haven't realized for a long time. So how do we simultaneously select for multiple traits? And so that, like you said, like we can't always just focus on one trait, because it's always going to be a trade-off somewhere else. And so how do we, you know, try to select for multiple traits? Because that's going to be really important, because they could have a negative effect in some way or not.
So how much further from the theory of VSH being additive do we get in that kind of a scenario, right? Because even it's, let's say it is 500 different alleles that are, you know, communicating the viral sensitive hygiene at a high degree in a population, and, you know, you want to add something else like temperament or color, you know, or whatever your, you know, soup du jour is as far as selection is concerned, you know, VSH has at least long been considered additive. And how many of that, those 500 alleles, do we need to have a stock that can resist varroa sufficiently to reduce or eliminate chemical dependence? Right? How much further do we get from that notion that it's additive and we're now over-selecting and it's too dominant?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So, yeah, because I'm not quite sure how to answer that yet, because, you know, it's still really, really preliminary, right? But I will say, just if we think about just the biology and the mating system of honeybees, like, I don't think it'll ever be an issue, right? Because you're always going to have, you know, mating where they're open mating. So even if, like, a breeder is strongly selecting for VSH and they're degrading genetic diversity that way, like, I still think the genetic diversity overall is going to be really high, you know, with the multiple mating and then the extremely high recombination rate. And if it ever becomes an issue, that's something to think about with gene banks and things like that. But I don't think it ever will be, because there won't be, like, it's not like 95% of the beekeepers in the U.S. will ever become bee breeders, and they'll constantly select for that, right? So that I don't think that'll ever be a major issue.
That's like a solution looking for a problem at this point.
You think of the livestock industry, like, all the stocks in the livestock industry are, like, highly selected for on these breeding farms, right? And so every single farmer has, like, highly selected stocks, and it's easy to cage two cows into a pen and mate them, right? And so that's why you have these inbreeding issues. But honeybees, like, you can never control the mating. I mean, even if you understand DCH, we'll never control the mating. And unless every single beekeeper, 90% of the beekeepers actually do like a closed breeding program, I don't think genetic diversity will ever be an issue.
But even then, like, let's just say we magically got to this place where all the managed honeybee colonies are resistant to varroa. Okay, well, now there's swarms all the time. And at that point, the swarms are going to become feral and self-sustaining. So then that evolution process is going to take place outside of beekeeper control. And so that genetic's going to happen. And then, I mean, yeah, the obvious insane rate of crossing over that happens within the species.
Yep.
It's just, I mean, that's just never going to be a problem.
Exactly. Yeah. Yep. Super high recombination, right?
Well, you should be breeding for VSH, basically.
The only question here that we didn't address, I was waiting for Cory to do it because he usually does, that you ask the person that's doing all this testing, that you also have to make sure that they're not blasting their colonies with oxalic acid in the fall and the winter, and then testing in the spring and magically having all these miraculous fours on the VSH scale and then selling you F1s because they have really good oxalic acid kill.
Yeah, that popped in my mind a couple of times, but the conversation went elsewhere. But yeah, and that's something that I don't like. If you Google Harbo Bee Company, click on VSH, click on Measure VSH, you've got the whole rundown. But the one thing that I noticed that I don't know that he articulated yet is if you just hammered your bees with Ametros and then you test them, you're going to get phenomenal scores. But that wasn't your bees suppressing the varroa or the reproduction. That was Ametros. So there's a, I almost feel like VSH selection and IPM are like at odds, because your best scores are going to be late season, but that's also the hardest time to raise queens and concentrate what your testing results are. I've noticed sometimes you'll have really late season super seed, so you get in and that colony still looks great in the spring, but it's not the same queen that was in there. So you have to start testing over again, unless you got your tests in the fall before you treated and you had a high enough varroa load that you got a definitive score, you know, and then she's marked and you know that's still her. You know, Harbo does cover that, to where if you test and you get a definitive score, the score will follow the queen basically for her life. But yeah, that's,
you need a solid 8 weeks
before
post-treatment or queen requeen.
If you requeen a colony and you put a new queen in there, then you need to wait minimum of 7 weeks, I think is what Kara said, 8 weeks preferably, to where you're actually testing that queen's progeny's response, not the previous queen's progeny's response.
Yeah, and I think,
and then Harbo says, I'm sorry, Matt, go ahead.
No, I just said what he just said, I think, is spot on, especially for people like us in the north. Like, we need to do that Harbo essay in August, September, where those mites are going to be the highest, before you treat and start cleaning them up for the fall. Identify those breeders, make sure they're marked, you know, mark the hive, and that's going to be your breeder for the following year. If they don't make it through the winter, then, you know, so be it. You want the winter to select for those that aren't going to make it through winter. So that's just another selection process. But now you have, let's just say she makes it through winter, she scored high on the Harbo scale, she made it through a Michigan winter, you can start breeding and grafting from her, you know, right in May. But yep. I do understand, yeah, I can... for someone like him, where he's trying to crank these things out, you know, back in April and you know, making breeders and then making, verifying that the breeder that he, you know, just eyed is in fact scoring a four to make sure he's selling his high quality product. You know, he's at a different time constraint than what we would be. But he's also not treating at all, so it doesn't matter, really.
And that's why I didn't, and I always tell people, because inevitably someone's like on a webinar or a big speech somewhere, they're like, oh, you know, don't you not treat, or get me to say that I don't treat. And then I always say, no, I don't treat, but here is why. This isn't a good management protocol. This is strictly because I want to get
to selecting
breeding. Yeah, I'm specifically selecting for this. You know, I feel like, wasn't it Socrates that got killed for leading Athens youth astray or something like that? I feel like I don't want to, that's why I'm always
leery, hesitant,
dodgy about saying I'm treatment free, because I don't want to lead the youth astray or a newbie.
Well, I mean, the ultimate outcome of most people who are treatment free, to whatever degree you're treatment free, however you define it, you're not using chemicals to control your varroa, you're not doing anything at all, or you're doing five things, or you're doing two things, whatever it is, the ultimate goal in that perspective is that I want a queen line. I want bees that can survive despite varroa, however, whatever method they're doing. But the problem with that approach is that there's not a definition of what the mechanism is, so that you can select for it perpetually. You're just basing it on survivorship. The one thing that we've discussed, I think, ad nauseum tonight, is that there are things that we can identify that can lead you down that path more quickly and with less bee death. Yep. It's painful for me to say that. So
Like, you know, I would rather just leave them and select from the winners. It's less work for me. There's a lot of work involved in like identifying which queens are doing what, doing assays and taking notes and breeding and bringing in queens from other people and looking for all these characteristics and setting up mating yards and like just all of this, like all of this straining and physicality involved in, you know, the process. But at the end of the day, you have something you can continue to work from. After all that work was done, you've made your work next year, next season, just a little easier. Not, you haven't solved the problem, but you're moving in a positive direction. And sure. And in Michigan, go ahead.
I was going to say, if you don't want to mess with any of that headache because it'll drive you completely insane, just support someone who is.
Like, yeah. Go to StevensBeeCo.com.
Or John Harbo. John Harbo was doing this whenever before I was even playing with bees, so he's a really good source. There's other sources, you know.
But it's not overly complex if you want to start it in your own apiary, even if you don't bring in any selected stock. You can, like, you 4 to 10% or 2 to 4% of unselected stock actually is hygienic. John Harbo discovered hygienic behavior in bees that were not selected. They were just a bunch of packages dumped off into a trough or whichever, you know, and they identified.
Wasn't there like 12 or something originally, and they didn't know exactly what it was, but they were purported to have some kind of resistance. And yeah, it was a small sample size, so you can definitely make strides in your backyard. You just have to do the work.
But and in the north, if you're going to do a Harbo, like Matt was implying, you need to have a varroa load to quantify it if you want to have a really good test. And then in Michigan or Ohio or most of the Midwest, we're going to make splits in June, and we're going to requeen those splits with queens from our own stock, or maybe we're going to bring in queens, or we're going to bring in some F1 virgins and do some open mating. And we can wait that 10-week period without treating those colonies and be able to at least get to the fall with a mite load and then come back and do an assay on those colonies and identify potential breeder queens for the spring. And we do it all again in June. So it's not overly complex or unapproachable, because you don't even have to graft that season. You're making walkaway splits with that good stock. Or you're adding in a, what? No walkaways? We know you don't like emergency.
I'm a plant snob, James.
Well, we only have one Cory Stevens, thank God.
James, this Cory Stevens about to pee his pants.
Well, go pee then.
We'll okay, see I'll you be later. Right back. I'll be right back. I was getting ready for you to wrap it up, but it hasn't happened yet, so I'm going to take a break.
And then, but what you're saying too, like, you know, so if you bring in the breeder, like really, so we brought in a breeder last year. We made a ton of F1s. Those F1s, you know, if we keep them, they're going to produce the drones that we talked about, which are theoretically 100% VSH. And it's actually not going to be this year, really, that you're going to see those results as much as it will be next year. If we did a decent job flooding that drone congregation area. So it is slow. I mean, obviously if like all these things that we've talked about, all these variables, if it was straightforward, we would have solved it a long time ago when the mite got here in what, 88. But it's obviously complex, it's slow, and it requires a lot of buy-in. And if it's not going to be bought in by the big commercial guys and the queen producers that are producing thousands and thousands of queens, it's going to require a lot of buy-in from thousands of backyarders, because we have to equate to the colonies, colony for colony. But it's definitely doable. I mean, especially with that, I really think the most one of the most powerful things is that slide that you brought up that Phoebe presented, that, you know, it high scoring UBO is, it does sustain itself even in areas where there's low
saturation.
Low scoring drones, it's still gonna linger there for a little bit. So Keep doing it, keep selecting it. And if you can convert more people to also do it, like you said, it's not hard. It does require decent eyesight or a magnifying glass and good lights and a long Saturday afternoon. But outside of that, it's doable. And you don't have to graft too, right? I mean, because once you identify the breeders, we can talk about inferior queens right now. Why Corey's gone? Oh, he's back. But you can still you could do a walkaway split from a high scoring UBO colony or VSH colony, and you know if you're going to do a walkaway split, you might as well do it from the best one. Or you know when we first started, we used OTS. And we used OTS to a very high degree, in my opinion. We had some great queens, and just start moving the frames from the high scoring SMR or VSH, move her egg frames into colonies that didn't score well, and let them make a queen with her genetics. And
well, really still, you still have good queens even now. Like even though there might not have been like some of the more complex selective pressures, like it. People talk about Matt's queens all the time. It's actually kind of annoying because I don't like when people give him compliments. but they talk about his queens all the time. And there's a good example. An individual purchased a nuke from him in the spring, you know, and in the fall, she was still measuring like, it was like less than 2% infestation, that even though
two
she just
mites. Yeah.
And you know, like that's without selection. Being quantified, you know, she just did a mite wash in the fall, and there was a lot of variables, like she might be in an area with low mite pressure and yada yada yada. The point is like he's been selecting from a curated stock for a period of time. He very well may have this in his population at a higher degree. If you look for it, you'll find it.
And like Michael Palmer's like selected for it without measuring for it as well, you know, and then they went in there, they measured it, and they're like, yep, it's here. And I mean, he just did it based on who's, like Corey said, the ones that are resistant are going to rise to the top. They're going to be your best producers. They're going to look the healthiest. They're going to be the ones that you want to split from in the spring. And so, yeah, I mean, you could get there, but like Corey has said, like now that you can measure it, you can get there even faster. Yeah. And if you're cheating like Corey and using II, you can get there even faster. But
or you can make problems for yourself faster too. Double-edged sword.
Yeah.
But
well, I could shave 10 years off of my course as well, because I could buy queens from the pole line program. If somebody's been selected to provide them, I could buy queens off of Corey or somebody else who's actually put in the work. I think I was reading an article the other day, if somebody wants to look it up. So Walrus and the Honeybee lunch with Randy Oliver, Randy Oliver had made the statement, like you can start from scratch in your selection process if you want, and you could put in the work, and you could, you know, commit to a dozen years before you start to see measurable progress, or you can identify somebody who is actually doing the work and has demonstrated progress and vetted their stock and answered that question I've been asking, like, how do I know what you're selling me is true? And I could start with their stock and shave 10 years off of my trajectory, right? And that's a wonderful thing. That's what's so great about all of the things that we've covered tonight. And I don't know if you're all holding your pee like Corey was, but we've been dragging on for about 2 hours, and now that he's ready to go for another two, we're ready to wrap up.
No, I really like the conversation. Yeah, and I'd like to have it again once you start your NQI.
The Northern Queen Initiative. Yep. Yeah, we're ready to go. I think we've got some good stuff happening here with that, and we've got a lot of good support from folks like you and Corey and a lot of other contributors that are helping a fledgling, you know, circumstance have a little bit more credibility with expert input, you know, and expert guidance. And I think that that's important. I've always felt like that's going to be what makes something like this successful, is that you're leaning on experts. Like we talked about, leaning on people who have done it and are verifying what they're doing, and you can implement that into your own program and really skip over some of the hurdles. Mm-hmm. So that's a beautiful thing. Garett, I appreciate you coming on, hanging out with us. And Corey, I'm very grateful that you came and hung out with us. And Matt, it's always a pleasure for your company, sir.
That was painful to say, wasn't it?
No, not really. Though it depends on the day, I think.
Garett, it was great to meet you. I kept thinking I would run into you eventually. I just haven't done it yet, so at least we got to catch up virtually.
Well next time I go to Baton Rouge, I'll stop in Missouri and check out your operation.
You're welcome anytime.
Bring your assay tools.
I say he'll put you to work. Bring your course out here.
I'll cook you some barbecue. Yeah.
Guys, I enjoyed it. Good conversation.
Yeah, everybody, have a good night. Thank you so much. I appreciate all you guys.
See you guys. Peace.